Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Chen Dynasty, aka twitch.tv/jchenzor. I am your host, James Chen.
Hello, everybody.
And
welcome.
I have an echo again. Dynasty, I really need to make sure I don't do this all the time. Which one is echoing?
James Chen.
Ah, it is the Ultra Chen TV window that I have open. Oh, there you go. But welcome to another episode. This is episode 8 of Unchenzored, where I just talk about various topics. I rant about things. I get angry. I get mad about things. I just basically speak my mind about a lot of situations. Now, this one's going to be interesting. This episode is going to be a little interesting because I really, really want to talk about DLC. Because just recently, Dragon Ball FighterZ just announced their release date, everything, and then a bunch of DLC information, and everybody started going crazy about it. Everyone started getting, like, really frustrated with the DLC and everything like that, and everybody was all mad and all this stuff. And hang on a second, let me do something here, make sure my phone is on silent. And do a couple of other things really quick. There it is. Okay. But basically, what I want to talk about is DLC, right? So a lot of people are mad at DLC. They're getting frustrated with it. And I put up these kind of tweets. I put up these tweets basically kind of defending DLC on Twitter just a while ago, and I had a lot of interesting responses, a lot of people talking about it. So, you know, what I've noticed here is that there is a very high aversion to DLC. In fact, so much to the point that I saw from the actual announcement from about the DLC from Bandai Namco was that all these people started responding that they're like, well, you messed up, you fucked up. We're not buying your game anymore. Oh, nice. Well, that your Capcom is showing. Goodbye. And like, there was all these people that were like super mad about it, right? They were super, super mad about it. A lot of people were saying that they might not even want to buy Dragon Ball anymore just because the DLC is there. And I don't know. Like, to me, I'm starting to think that there's a problem here. I really think that we need to kind of think about this a little bit, because in my opinion, yeah, okay, I know a lot of people are mad about DLC because it feels like, you know, it's, you know, milking people, you know, microtransactioning people to death, etc., etc. But the main thing that I want to bring up is that I don't think DLC is necessarily a bad thing. And the whole impetus for this episode is I kind of wanted to talk about this viewpoint, and I really wanted to... definitely this goes much deeper than fighting game DLC, and we will get into that. We will get into that for sure. But the reason why I want to bring this up is because I want to talk about why I think it's not necessarily as bad, and yes, I'm going to bring up the inflation argument, okay? So I'm just going to start by talking about the inflation argument. And I've had a lot of people fight me with this one. They've argued with me that games weren't that expensive, that they weren't, you know, a lot of money, like they were $50 for a while, etc., etc. But as a person who grew up playing, like, Super Nintendo and Genesis games, video games were hella expensive a long time ago. And in fact, I've done the calculations, $60 games that I used to buy on the Super Nintendo all the time. And, you know, there have been pictures tweeted on the internet showing advertisements from stores showing, like, Chrono Trigger for, like, $80. And there was a Sega Saturn game for $85 on another advertisement. I spent a shit ton of money on Street Fighter 2, for example. When that game came out, Chrono Trigger was super expensive. Final Fantasy 3, 6 was really expensive. Dude, don't even talk about Phantasy Star 4 for the Sega Genesis. Those games were super expensive. And if you take the inflation calculator and actually calculate it, that's basically about $97 today. $60 back then is $97 today. And we're still buying most AAA titles for only $60. So in my viewpoint here, what this actually comes down to is that we're paying incomplete prices. And so a lot of people are arguing one of the crappiest things about DLC is that they're giving us incomplete games. Incomplete games. And so that sucks. We're paying full price for an incomplete game. I don't see it that way. I see it as we are paying incomplete prices for incomplete games. And then you basically spend another $30 for the DLC, and that kind of makes up for it. And, you know, I do have to give one caveat in the fact that I have a lot of friends who are in the gaming industry, who are devs in the gaming industry, and I know that they're working 80 hours a week, 100 hours a week. They, you know, basically it's a shitty industry to be in right now. And so a lot of these guys are underpaid and everything like that. So I know how much struggle these guys go to. So, you know, being able to have more content to work on, to try to get a little bit more of the, what do you call that? What is it when you get, the word is in my head, but I can't get it out of my brain right now. Where when the product sells, you get a little bit of that, you know, money alongside with it. So I feel like, you know, with the rising costs of these games and everything like that, the fact that people are getting frustrated at paying continually $60 is a little misguided because commission. Thank you, Mr. Friday. Thank you, commission. And Yams and Jams, he said it as well. So dude, I can't even imagine anybody is not believing that the gaming industry is underpaid. The people in charge, it's the same situation as everything, right? It's the people in charge who are making all the money, right? Yes, and Uber Automation has that right? So underpaid workers does not equal underpaid industry, for sure. But, you know, a lot of these guys, a lot of studios are getting shuttered. I know people, you know, once a game ships, the company just lets everybody go. And then there's not. So, you know, with DLC, that gives them the opportunity to continue to work. It's an interesting situation right now. But honestly, the cost of games are ridiculous, right? So the cost to make a game these days is absolutely going through the roof right now. And I'm going to see if I can do something here. If I can actually make this work. Let's see here. I'm going to add a screen capture here. There we go. So I have some screen captures. Like, I've been checking out these articles. I've been reading articles about how much it costs to make games and stuff. It's probably hard to see these pages here right now, so I apologize about this. But, you know, for example, there was this chart that I saw on this article over here that's just basically talking about how much the cost of gaming have grown exponentially like this. You can see right here, this is from Factor 5. Sorry, it's my screen capture is messed up over here. But this is from Factor 5, and they're showing how 16-bit games cost at max 300K. And as time went on to Nintendo 64, to GameCube, to, you know, first Nixon, to Layer, actual AAA next gen is now up to 20 million. So we have some situations here where these games, literally, they are going crazy. Yes. Hopefully people can actually see this clearly here. And then let me see if I have some of this. So there's another article here where Kotaku actually gathered a bunch of people talking about how much games cost to make just by word of mouth. And you can see in the early 2000s that it started around, you know, 5.7 million, 3 million. By the time we get halfway through, we're starting to get movies that are games that are up to 20 million. Even Shaolin Monks was basically $20 million. And then as we keep going, you know, we end up with Halo MMO is $90 million. You know, Golden Axe Beast Rider is 50. Why is this game $15 million? That doesn't make any sense at all whatsoever. But, you know, 2009, things are getting more expensive. God of War 3 cost $44 million. Okay, Shaolin Monks was a fucking fantastic game, dude. I love that game. And then by the time we get to here, you know, we've got 2 million, 70 million, and all these crazy, ridiculous prices, 50 million here. And by the time we get to Destiny, we have like 140 million. It's pretty crazy. It's pretty crazy. And no, I'm not saying they should make fighting games like they did 20 years ago with sprites, unless you're responding to someone else. It's pretty crazy how much games have gone up. And I was reading this article written by somebody who actually has worked in the gaming industry before. He's talking about how in Half-Life he created this model here with only 308 triangles, you know, just 136 kilobytes of texture, 29 bones. And now, like, something from a similar game a decade later has 11 million triangles, 12,289 kilobytes of textures, and 159 bones. He said that basically the first one took about 2 weeks working to make that, and now the later ones probably take weeks, more like 7 weeks to create that. And you know, it's not even just about designing the models. It used to be just one person could design the models, hope the lighting was okay, etc., etc. But here you can see right now texturing and shading and animation are so much more sophisticated than they were back then. It's nuts, right? And so one of the things that I have all these articles here talking about this. Also, this article here from The Economist was talking about this. And just, you know, how even nowadays that you... I think it's in here somewhere. I meant to highlight it. My apologies. But, yeah, so here, these days, Hollywood actors are hired and paid handsomely to voice actors. And then there's also market testing, which costs a lot of money. Marketing is a lot of money, etc., etc. So these games basically are starting to exponentially grow in terms of how to make them. And you know what? To be honest with you, almost all of the blame for all the problems that's been going on with this, you know, is really the fact that games are so damn expensive to make nowadays. And I really think that there's this problem with the gaming industry, and this is a whole nother topic altogether, and this is probably what a lot of people were actually talking about. Yeah, there's definitely a lot of good tools to develop these things, but a lot of games still have to be developed from scratch. So even though you have something like an Unreal Engine, you know, to help you make a game, once you've crafted the game, you've spent so much resources making this game that if you just made this really short game and sold it really quickly for a small price, man, and then start a brand new game where you gotta recreate a whole bunch of new things again, like, it's just not realistic in terms of game development. So what you end up doing is making these super long games, which are like 60 hours long, which I think to this day, like, long games, I hate them, okay? I hate long games. I wish games weren't that long. I've already put in 90 hours into Breath of the Wild, and I still haven't finished that game. And it's like, my God, can I just play these games for like 16 hours and be done with them, you know, at this point? And then on top of that, since they did all that, then it also makes more sense for them to create some DLC to actually, one, recoup a lot of those costs, and two, to continue to take advantage of the fact that they created all these tools for just this specific game. You know, not every game is guaranteed to have a sequel. If you have a sequel, sometimes it's nice. Some sequels are even written completely from scratch, right? They're actually written from scratch. And yeah, exactly. Mario 1 had like 5 devs, and I believe like the whole game fit in like, is like smaller than a JPEG of Super Mario Brothers, as my friend put it just recently. The actual game of Super Mario Brothers is smaller than like a JPEG of the screenshot or a PNG of the screenshot of Mario Brothers these days. Now, there is one thing to say. So Malice's Godlike has brought up a very good point, is that there's a lot of small games now. So one of the articles here that I had on here talked about this. I'm trying to find the right one here. But basically, the average cost to make a video game has actually dropped in the past few years. It has actually gone down. But that is because there's a lot more indie games now. And indie games can get away with doing these things. They can purposely make retro graphics. They are designed with smaller teams. That's all their company was put together for. One of the most recent examples, for example, was Cuphead. Right? Cuphead was a game that three guys started to make, and once it started gathering steam, they had to hire a lot more people. And, you know, there was countless articles going out there that were talking about how the developers had to mortgage their homes, they had to sell everything that they had, like they quit their jobs to make this game. And so basically they lost a shit ton of money making this. Let's talk about Lab Zero, right? What they had to go through to make Skullgirls. Them as well. I know for a fact that for a long time developing Skullgirls, those devs were not making any money. They were making nothing. They weren't even getting paid. They were literally making this game because they just love it and, you know, hopefully getting enough from crowdfunding. I don't even know if they had a lot in venture capital. You know, I should have brought Mike Z on here to talk about all these things. And so, you know, eventually they crowdfunded, they made a bunch of DLC characters, and, you know, it worked out that way. But even then they said, oh, a DLC character is like $500,000. And everybody's like, what the hell are you talking about? Like, how can a character cost $500,000? It should be like $6,000 or it should be like $5,000 to make a character. So, but yeah, Cuphead sold a lot of money. So it actually paid off for them, but it paid off for Cuphead. But how many developers out there does this not pay off for? There was that documentary that talked to all the different indie developers, like the guy who created Fez, and just how much that basically destroyed his life, almost completely destroyed him. Let me go back over here. There was an article over here where this developer here, game designer Kim Swift, who apparently used to work for Amazon Game Studios. This article was written a few years ago, and it said that there was a secret game for Amazon Game Studios, which I'm assuming now is probably Breakaway that we've all seen. But, you know, she's sitting here talking about how much it takes to create a character. And, you know, she says that, you know, in 2 weeks making a character design with a salary of about $3,000. And that's lowballing it, too. $3,000 for 2 weeks with a game salary is probably pretty low. But then other specialists working on characters would include character artists, etc., etc. But then also added costs of office space, computers, software, utilities. The total cost of one character is around $80,000. And that's just one character, she said. Extrapolate that out to multiple characters and environments, and it gets expensive fast. Right? And we're not even talking about fighting games, because creating a character for a non-fighting game, I'm sure, is infinitely simpler than it is for creating one for a fighting game, because God, so many. Yeah, and that's assuming no revisions too. Abigail definitely didn't cost $80,000. Abigail cost, I mean, according to the rumors, right, the DLC for Street Fighter V had a bigger budget than MVCI, which, I mean, honestly, when looking at the last three DLC characters for Street Fighter, makes total sense, because those three characters are so, like, Abigail, Manat, and Zeku are so well done in terms of style and personality and everything like that. I really love a lot of that stuff. So just going back to the whole entire thing, game development has increased ridiculous. Yes, the market for video games has also increased substantially. So while the costs have increased exponentially, the market share has increased exponentially, but still not as much to match the costs to make games. And then the price of games has barely gone up. It's barely gone. So let's say we even take the $50 games from the PlayStation 2 era, right? $50 games till now is about $70, right? But it's still, that's a $20 increase for, like, just exponential growth in terms of cost, right? So I had a whole argument with one of my friends about this before, because we were talking about Mario Kart, and he was really frustrated that Mario Kart had DLC. And, you know, the trick really comes down to the fact that, do we have a situation where the initial product that you got is actually a full product? hang on, let me see what Big Red Couch here says. ASW quoted that it takes about 2 to 3 months for an artist to make an entire character during one of their panels. So yeah, that is a lot. Yeah. Dude, Sky to the Walker, actually that whole thing about buying games secondhand is a problem. That's also another reason why games have gone up in price, that and piracy as well, because when you sell games secondhand, GameStop makes all of that money. That doesn't go into any of the game sales of the actual company. And so buying and selling of used games is just a huge market. It's a huge industry. It's actually very harmful to the game industry. It saves people little bits of money and doesn't give anything back to the gaming industry, which is kind of like not a really good thing. Yeah, so Mario Kart is an exception, right? Because when Mario Kart came out, you did get a full game. You got as many tracks as you did in a normal game. You got just about as many characters, and they added DLC, which... So normal Mario Kart games always have 8 circuits with 4 tracks each. Mario Kart 8 came out with 8 circuits, 4 tracks each, 32 tracks total, lots of characters. There's nothing missing from it, so when they added the DLC... I wasn't bothered. I was like, I don't know why you'd be mad about this. And my friend was really upset about it. He's like, I don't want to buy it. I don't want to see it advertised in game. I don't want to see grayed out sections on my menu screen because that just looks tacky and everything like that. And he was really, really frustrated. That is the way that first sale doctrine works. That's the way it works. And again, it's all kind of a weird spiraling cycle, right? Because movies don't even cost that much. There's not a lot of used movies. There's not a lot of way, you know, like used movie market. There's not really a big used movie market. Things are going digital now, but even before it was digital, everyone bought movies. Like, they just bought it and they didn't actually sell or trade or do any of that kind of stuff. But the nice thing about movies is they have multiple avenues to make money. They go to the box office, then they go to the digital or the cable channels, then they go to DVD sales, etc., etc. They go to airplanes first. Movies have like multiple tiers in which they can make money, and video games do not have that. And so they basically have to rely on sales and DLC to try to make up a lot of that money. Games 10 years ago sucked mostly. Really in 2MK, I will probably say that one of the greatest consoles ever made was the PlayStation, because Metal Gear Solid came out on that, Castlevania Symphonies of the Night came out on that, Resident Evil existed on those, Resident Evil 2, etc., etc. But I will tell you right now, God, the amount of crap that was on the PS1, oh my God. Like, you walked into the store and you looked at the shelves of PS1 games, there was so many crappy games, dude. So many crappy games. Holy crap. Hey man, don't knock on Friday the 13th on the Nintendo. Come on, everyone wants to throw rocks at Jason. Dude, that game was, oh my God, it was so bad. It was so bad. Yeah, mostly there was just nothing but garbage on that console. A lot of PS2 shovelware, etc. And that actually contributes to a lot of the problems too, is that a lot of people, one of the things that I haven't actually talked about is the concept of marketing. Marketing is a huge problem now, is that people have to spend so much goddamn money on marketing their video games because there are so many goddamn video games being made today. There's so many games that marketing can make or break a game, and that sucks. And now you have to spend all this money on marketing, and if you don't market it well, I mean, look at MVCI. I'm assuming they barely had any marketing budget. Half the people out, one of the reasons why it didn't sell well probably was because no one even knew the game was coming out. Right? No one probably even knew Marvel vs. Capcom Infinite was even happening. I remember Olaf saying that when he went to Comic-Con and like people were standing there like, oh, what is this game? I've never heard of it. Like, that is such a really, really big problem, in my opinion. Dude, there was a recent poll on Twitter, okay, that talked about like what's the best video game soundtrack of all time, and I think Halo won, and I was like, what the fuck? Like, sorry for the tangent here, but if your answer is not either A, something written by Nobuo Uematsu, a game where the soundtrack was done by Nobuo Uematsu, or two, not a game from the Nintendo Entertainment System, you are wrong. You are wrong. Guaranteed. Guaranteed, I'm telling you, even with the poor sound chips, Nintendo has absolutely by far the greatest music out of any console. Any console. Guaranteed, Nintendo has the best music, dude. Like, even games that nobody really even knew about. I'm gonna get an amen from people in the chat who've actually played this game, but Journey to Silas, which was originally supposed to be Terminator, but they lost the contract, so they just turned the game to Journey to Silas. Dude, you listen to that fucking soundtrack? Oh my god. Blaster Master, Bionic Commando, Jesus Christ, these games. All the Mega Man games, Mega Man 2. Mega Man 2 is like some of the greatest music ever. Dude, you want me to play some of the songs? Okay, now I'm totally getting off track here. Actually, you know what? I might even have it on my phone here. It's not going to come out very clear, but this might be the most accurate way for me to play them. Oh no, I can't do it. I can't do it on my phone. Okay, I'll have to do it somewhere else. But in any case, look, Nintendo had some of the greatest music ever created, right? And so, anyways, back to the original topic at hand, DLC. So basically, the crux of what I'm trying to say is that a lot of the problems right now is that the game costs are so high. And honestly, DLC, in my opinion, isn't the problem. The problem really is that games are that expensive to make. I've talked to people, like I said, I have a lot of friends in the gaming industry, and I've talked to them, and they're just like, you know what? It's like, imagine making a movie, but when you make the movie, every time you made a new movie, you had to build a brand new camera. You had to build a new studio so that you can create the set. You had to, like, reinvent film. And you had to, you know, you had to sew the clothes yourself to actually, you know, clothe people. It's just like, you actually had to, like, harvest the cotton to make the fabric to actually make the clothes, etc., etc. Arcade game soundtracks from Taito and Konami. Okay, I accept that. So, right. So, here's the problem. So, as I was saying, I think before I got sidetracked, the cost of games have gone down, right? I'm sorry, I'm starting to ramble a little bit here. And I'm kind of going off through all the topics because I'm looking at the chat here and I keep responding to things in the chat. But indie games have really lowered the cost of making video games overall because they are allowed to, you know, make games with worse graphics, and they can make, you know, 8-bit music because it's charming, etc., etc. And then there's the AAA games, which, I mean, look what happened to MVCI, right? I mean, Street Fighter V came out, wasn't a terrible looking game. Obviously, there was clipping and Ken's face had issues, which I guess was fixed. I don't know. People are saying that Ken's face was fixed. I'm going to have to take a look at that. But when I boot up Street Fighter again. But, you know, Street Fighter had all these, you know, small graphical issues. But for the most part, it's not a terrible looking game, right? But people were mad at the gameplay. So in Marvel vs. Capcom Infinite, they spent most of their time trying to work on the gameplay as opposed to the graphics. But when you make a AAA title and the graphics aren't very good, you are just going to get destroyed. You are basically going to get blown up. And that's exactly what happened to MVCI. So now with all these AAA games, you're so pressured to spend all this money to make sure you have epic cinematic music, which sucks, by the way, because I hate cinematic scores for video games. And then you've got to make sure that you have, Hollywood voice actors, like the article was saying. You have to do all these crazy things to make a AAA title. You can't just go... You can't be modest with AAA titles anymore, or you end up with something like MVCI, and then everyone gets mad at that, and it doesn't sell at all, right? And so what happens is what it's done to the video game industry is it's kind of killed the middle game. We basically only have indie games, and we only have AAA games, and everything in the middle is gone. And honestly, the middle of the game the middle is where all the great games came from. It makes me really sad because if you think about it, like on the Super Nintendo days, you know, people could afford to try to do something risky. People can't afford to do that anymore. They just can't. Like, it sucks that you read these articles and it's like, this game has to sell 350 million copies to make a profit. And it's like, what? Why would you set yourself up for that? Like, in what planet would you think to yourself, I need to make this game and sell 350 million copies to make a profit? Like, what kind of stupid industry is this? And so, I just feel like a lot of, the 32-bit era, 16-bit era, I would say, is where most of the risks were taken, to be honest with you. I feel like that's where the Super Nintendo and the Genesis days are where you came up with a lot of great things. I mean, Blizzard, when they were basically nobodies, made a game called The Lost Vikings on the Super Nintendo, which was one of the fucking greatest games ever. Oh, God, there's a game with a great soundtrack. There's a game with a great soundtrack, absolutely. Yeah, and a lot of that, you know, people thought $30 to $40 games were crappy $60 games. That's true, too. And there's a weird perception problem there as well, that if you charge games for lower price, people think that they're not as well made, etc., etc. So, the Sega Saturn was a great console. Although it was mostly for fighting games, though. Fighting games on Saturn fighting games were super good. Super, super good. But I think the main problem right now is that this has turned into a talk about nothing but like the craziness of the game industry and everything like that. But the middle games are not working anymore. And so you either have these indie games where people mortgage their houses and quit their jobs to make, or you have these AAA titles. And these AAA titles cost so much to make that they kind of have to make these DLC. To get back to the original topic, they have to make the DLC to make up for it. So one of the main arguments that I've always heard is that you're paying $60 now for an incomplete game. And even as a person who kind of defends DLC in a lot of way, I don't deny that. In fact, that's part of my whole point as well, is that you're paying $60 for an incomplete game. Because $60 is not really a complete price anymore these days. And the way that I actually like to think about it, right? Like, let's think about, you know, okay, Mr. Friday, we'll get to Street Fighter V in a second. We'll get to Street Fighter V in a second. Because that's actually a really great way to put it. That Street Fighter V is a great example of why DLC actually works. But let's talk about this buying an incomplete game for $60. All of us, at one point in time of our lives, have bought a game that looked great, that had a lot of potential, turned out the game sucked. Turned out the game was crap. No Man's Sky, for example, is probably the most recent one I can think of. A lot of people were excited for that game. Apparently that game turned out to be suckage beyond all reason, right? So here's the thing, right? For Honor, I've heard a lot of people, yeah, some people were mad at Crash Bandicoot as well, etc., etc. All of us have bought bad games in the past. Now, on the Super Nintendo days, when you bought a bad game, you spent the $60, and that was it. You got fucked. You bought it, and that was it, right? You're like, fuck, this game sucks. And you're done. Nowadays, with the DLC model, what's interesting now is that we're buying incomplete games for incomplete prices, but if you buy a game that sucks, you only spent two-thirds of the money, and then you basically get to save a third of that money. If games had gone up with inflation, and it was $90 right now to buy a game, you would buy a game for $90, and then you would have a shitty game for $90. Now you can spend $60 for a shitty game, say, I don't like this game, don't spend the $30 for the DLC or the season pass or whatever, and it works out fine, right? Street Fighter V was a great example of that. So let's talk about Street Fighter V. Let's buy it for $60. A lot of people weren't happy with it. A lot of people probably didn't buy the season pass and everything like that. But let's think about DLC with regards to fighting games in... Okay, Big Red Couch. We will get to that. We will get to that in a second. We will get to that in a second. Yeah, but Cuphead, like I said, is an indie game. It's a creator with a small studio. It was a small studio, right? So, and here's the thing. Season passes, don't buy the season pass right away. The season pass never goes away. The season pass is always there. There's no expiration date on a season pass. Okay, so if you don't like the concept of season pass, don't buy the season pass. Wait. Just wait. You know, like, there's no reason to buy, like, when Street Fighter 5 third season arcade edition comes out and there's another season pass, don't buy it. Just wait. Wait to see them announce the characters, and if they finally announce character that you want, then buy the season pass. Or wait till the end to buy it to determine whether it's worth it or not. Like, honestly, buying a season pass early is kind of your fault in a way. Honestly, just don't buy the season pass. Don't buy the season pass. Honestly, like, just don't do it. And Nutticon has run into a situation where he bought a season pass and they didn't really deliver anything. So, right, Crime Fighter? Yep, that's how it works. But just don't buy it. Don't buy the season pass. In fact, for me, I've gotten games late and I've been like, oh yeah, the season pass, and I went and bought the season pass like a year later, right? So it's not something that you have to get right away. But let's think about Street Fighter V here, okay? Let's think about Street Fighter V for a second here. We bought Street Fighter V for $60. And then let's say you did buy the season pass. I bought the season pass for $30. And then I bought the second season pass for another $30. And this is a true story. I bought all of those things. I bought all of those things. So I spent $120. So everyone's like, fuck this. I spent twice as much for this one game. This fucking sucks, right? But now here's the thing, right? Let's think about this for a little bit. Let's think about this. What's coming out in next year is Street Fighter V Arcade Edition, right? And for those people who bought Street Fighter V, it's going to be free. In the past, I don't even want to talk to you how many versions of Street Fighter II I've bought, okay? I don't even want to talk about it. Starting from the Super Nintendo with Street Fighter II, then Hyper Fighting, then Super Street Fighter II, and then Street Fighter II Classics, and then Street Fighter Alpha 1 I bought, and then I bought Alpha 2, then I bought Alpha 3, and then I bought CVS 1, then I bought CVS 1 Pro, which was an import from Japan. Then I bought CVS 2. I bought Marvel vs. Capcom 1. I bought Marvel vs. Capcom 2. I bought Marvel vs. Capcom 3. Ultimate Marvel vs. Capcom 3. I bought Street Fighter 4. I bought Super Street Fighter 4. I bought Street Fighter 4 Arcade Edition. I bought Street Fighter 4 Arcade Edition AE 2012, which I didn't do because that was a free upgrade. But I did buy Ultra Street Fighter 4, etc., 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 etc. I spent a fuck ton of money for these games. And understand, from Street Fighter to Street Fighter 2 to Street Fighter Hyper Fighting, I got four characters, and Hyper Fighting was like $70, $80, okay? So I bought the original for like $70, and then I bought the sequel for like $80, and then Super was the same thing, which only gave me another four characters, which was, again, like another fucking $80 that I spent on that shit way back then. Like, blah! Like, you know, now what we have in this situation with Street Fighter V is, if we didn't have the DLC route, what would have happened is we would have bought $60 for Street Fighter V, had nothing for 2 years, and then Super would have came out with 12 new characters. Super would come out and have 12 characters, which would be Urien, Balrog, Guile, Alex, you know, Ibuki, Minot, Ed, Zeku, Akuma, you know, etc., etc. And we would have paid another $60 for it, because it would have been a brand new game. We would have paid another $60 for it. What we've actually done here with Street Fighter V, however, is we're paying basically the exact same amount of money, and some people have taken the time to actually earn most of their characters through fight money. But let's say you didn't. Let's say you did buy the season passes. You spent $120, and now you're getting a free upgrade. So essentially, you've spent the same amount of money that you would have had we not had DLC. And on top of all that, we have been able to play all the new DLC characters. We have been getting new characters for 2 years. Now, whether you like the new characters or not, no matter what you think about those characters, I'll tell you this right now. It keeps things fresh. We keep getting new content, and like, even at tournaments and stuff like that, we get new characters and we see new things happening. And I think that's actually really kind of cool. Right, I actually think that would be really kind of cool. Rue would have been top tier for 2 years. That's probably true, actually. So Ryu is probably not the Ryu fans are not happy about that. Yeah, it'd be nice if MVCI had fight money, to be honest with you. But man, they're not making any money on that game at all right now. You can fish new characters in Guilty Gear, but good freaking luck on that one. That one is really hard. That one's really hard to do. But, look, what I'm trying to say is that Street Fighter V, as much as people have probably been mad about the way the DLC and having to pay money for them, buying these season passes, really, honestly, I feel like we've benefited from that. We haven't necessarily saved money. We would have spent the exact same amount of money, but you end up in a situation where you have been able to play these characters during the course of the 2 years, you know, and that's cool. Now, obviously, everyone's going to be like, James, you're a Capcom shill. Of course, you're telling us that everything's all great. Let's bring this up to what generated the discussion in the first place, which is Dragon Ball FighterZ, right? Dragon Ball FighterZ was announced to come out in January. I think it's January 26th. And then they announced that there is going to be a season pass for that for $35, which will include 8 characters. And everybody got really mad at that because they're like, I don't want to spend $35 on a season pass. This sucks. Like, you're withholding content from the game and forcing us to... I mean, in my opinion, the way that I look at it is that that means after the game comes out, we know they're going to support the game. They're going to keep working on it. And if they keep coming out with 8 characters as time goes on, that's cool. And as with Street Fighter V, whenever new characters drop, they can add balance changes if they want to. They can fix little things here and there. And so they can fix things that, like, for example, when the Monok patch came out, I didn't even realize they added in the training mode the ability to turn off the playback display in training mode so you can set the computer up to random and actually try to deal with situations without seeing exactly which one is going to be play. So... Right, really into MK, I will definitely get to that. I will definitely get to that, so. But, you know, to me, I'm excited about that. That means that Dragon Ball is going to be continually supported. They're going to keep making characters, and I'm okay with that, right? And I'm okay with that, and I'm happy about that. Now, So I've talked about all of this stuff from a very objective standpoint, right? I've talked about this from, you know, rising costs of games and all this stuff like that, all these different things that have been going on with people and with developers and companies and why DLC is kind of necessary to make up. However, that's all subject. I'm sorry, that's all objective, right? We can look at the numbers. We can actually look at the numbers of stuff going up. We can actually look at the numbers of game sales. We can look at the numbers of how much things cost, etc., whether the value is. But let's talk about the subjective stuff. This is where a lot of people have been talking to me on Twitter about this. A lot of people are mad about a lot of different things, right? So let's go through these things one by one. One, a lot of people are mad because the season pass, you don't even know what you're getting. You're basically spending $35 or $30 or $25 on faith. You're literally spending money on faith because you are buying a promise. And promises can definitely be broken. And that is a huge problem. And that is definitely, definitely a problem with season passes. Especially because they're oftentimes now announced before the game is even out. And that's where a lot of people are having a lot of problems. They're mad that they've announced the season pass even before the game came out. So to them, it feels like they could work on the game a little bit longer and put all 8 characters in there and then sell it for $60 that way. But nope, they're going to release it early and then charge you $35 to get 80 more characters. So it feels like they're shortchanging you in a lot of ways. And I totally get that. I totally, totally get that. I totally get that. So in terms of the season pass being like an empty promise, yeah, season pass is like crowdfunding. It absolutely is. devs want you to buy the season pass as an indication, as a justification for them to continue to work on content. Because if you don't buy the season pass, if no one buys it, then they're like, why bother working on more stuff, right? Like, I even wonder if we're even going to get a season two of Marvel vs. Capcom Infinite Characters at the rate this is going. I honestly don't feel like that's actually going to happen. But the thing about it is, as I mentioned with the season pass before, is that you don't have to buy it right away. And this is one of the things that I think is really, really important. When you see the season passes, and sometimes they go on sale too. So just, if you don't feel comfortable with buying a season pass, just don't do it. Just don't do it. Buy the game, see if you enjoy it. It's like basically testing a game for 2/3 the price. And then if you do enjoy it, you can spend the rest of the money. And with something like Dragon Ball FighterZ, it looks like that game is made with love. That game looks like the attention to detail is ridiculous. It's going to be so hype. It's going to be so much fun to play with your friends and everything like that. And I think the game is going to be fantastic. So I'm probably going to buy the season pass right away, because plus another thing is, I'm a commentator. I kind of have to make sure I get all the characters no matter what. So that's why I buy the season passes. So it's a different situation. So my situation's unique. So disregard that. But I feel like that the game is going to be worth it for that, because Dragon Ball definitely seems like it's been made with a lot of love. It's also used as an objective way of measuring interest, like pre-orders, unfortunately. Yes, it can be used as a means to ask for more money internally. Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. So that's one thing, right? Season passes, you don't have to buy the season pass. You just don't have to buy it right away. Hold off on it, because they don't go anywhere. The season pass will be there for a very long time. And if the season pass is going away, there will probably be Shoryuken.com articles and Event Hub articles about that. So I wouldn't worry too much about that. So just, you know, don't feel the temptation to buy the season pass right away. Just don't do it. Hold off on it. Wait. And then the other thing too is, you know, the whole concept that people are mad that it feels like devs are withholding content to release an unfinished game so that they make you buy the... Yeah, that's exactly what my point was earlier, right? That's absolutely what they're doing. That's 100% what they're doing, right? They're giving you part of a game and then hoping you'll like it enough to buy the rest of the game. And I mean, It sucks, but if you're a business, you would kind of do the same. I'm just saying. So I feel like that's something that we just have to accept. This is just the way that games are going these days, especially with the way that costs have gone up so much for these games. And, you know, people are like, well, what's the point of, like, you know, spending so much money on voice actors and blah, blah, blah. I mean, look at how many people are complaining about MVCI. It's not like a long time ago where you can go and watch a game like Mega Man X4 and see, what am I fighting for? And just, like, laugh about it and move on with it. Now, if you have bad voice acting so that you have Firebrand going, then, like, people get really, really pissed off. They get really pissed off. But I mean, like, you could go back in the old days and go play some of those old, oh god, what is that game called? Last Assault or whatever, TurboGrafx game, where, oh man, you just have to go to Video Game Atrocities. Is that what it was? Video Atrocities. Oh shoot, what is it? Video Game Dialogue Atrocities. God, what the heck? Audio Atrocities. That's what it is. Audio Atrocities. Go to Audio Atrocities and just download all the clips in there, man. Because this is one of the greatest sites ever, dude. I love this site to death. And which one? Last Alert. Oh my god. Last Alert. Oh, Jesus.
You've shown me some fancy action here. The damages on this ship and the weapons aboard will come to $1 billion.
People will hate you, Steve, if you're too stingy.
Like, he called him stingy. He couldn't even pronounce stingy right. He said stingy. Stingy. Oh my god.
Why would a hireling soldier like you run such a risk to torment me like this? Why?
Garcia, nobody can hire my feelings.
Dude, every time I come to the site, I get lost here for so long. I just end up listening to these all day. Where's my favorite one? It was from Bust a Move. Oh, God, what is it? Super Bust a Move, right? Yeah, there we go. Oh, God. This is one, like, I have not been able to imitate the amount of disinterest of this voice actor. This voice actor is literally reading an article while doing this, and she has no care about doing an actual job.
Oh, they are still chasing me. Wah!
it's one of my favorites. It's one of my favorites. I cannot imitate that to save my life. And then there, Shenmue, dude. Shenmue. Shenmue had some great ones. Shenmue 2. Let me see.
Can you help me?
I don't know.
I understand.
I mean, this is the thing. We can't get away with this stuff anymore. We cannot get away with this anymore these days. And it's really, really bad. And, oh, God, where is it? Oh, God. And they can't even be bothered to fix errors. Like, they actually mess up and they keep going.
You must recover all the energy immediately, Mega Man.
But where is Dr. Wily?
That's a good question. We may be able to locate another energy emission from the radar room. When we find that meteor, we'll find Dr. Wily.
Two mistakes during that thing, man. Two mistakes. Oh my god, so great. But that's the thing, right? So, you know, I don't even know where the hell I was before I went onto this tangent over here. But, you know, AAA titles can't get away with a lot of these small things like this. So, what was I talking about? So, like, yeah. So, these games cost a lot to make. So, they're going to sell you a smaller portion of the game for the $60 price, and then you're going to get the rest of the game for $30 to $35. And that's just the way it works, unfortunately. And it's not... it's not something that, you know, is great, but again, the nice thing about it is we really don't have to, and you know what, I swear to God, half the games that I play these days, I start and I don't even finish. Like, I'll play partway through and then I don't even finish. And so, if the games went up with inflation, I would have spent $90 on a game and then not finish it. I buy games that I don't even open. I have so many games that are sealed right now. My Last Guardian is sealed. My Ni No Kuni is still sealed. I have like a shit ton of Wii U games that are still sealed. I have, my backlog is so sad. My Final Fantasy 15 is still sealed. And I just bought more games today. What the fuck am I doing? Jesus Christ. I pre-ordered Super Mario Odyssey today. What the hell am I actually doing? So here's the thing, like, you end up buying all these games, and sometimes you don't finish them, and if the prices have gone up with inflation, you would have spent $90 for a game that's sitting there on your shelf, but as a result of DLC, you spend $60 on the game, and then don't spend the other $90. I just don't see it as necessarily that negative of a thing when it comes to DLC. You know, I just don't see it. So, you know, back to that whole point that a lot of people are complaining about, the season pass stuff, because you don't know what's in it, etc., etc. Okay, so there's another point I want to make of that. So, you know, what, buying a season pass on faith, right? Don't do it. Just don't buy the season pass. Wait. And unless you really are sure that you just want it, then just go ahead and buy it. But if you aren't sure and you want to know what more content is going to be in it, just wait for it, right? Wait for it. Number two, my second point on that, this is the game companies. Stop fucking doing this. Okay? Just tell us what is in these goddamn season passes, because yes, I know they can change their mind during the course of the year, so they're trying to give themselves a little leeway, I'm sure. But, man, like, if I found out season two was going to be Akuma and then these five characters like this, like, you know, when their character reveal trailer came out, I would have been just as interested. I would have been just as excited for it. If Arcade Edition Season 3 was like, hey, we're going to add Sagat and Sakura and Blanca and Sodom and Honda and blah, 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 I'd be like, yes! I would buy the season pass now. I would be super excited for it. And then as the character trailers came out, I'd be waiting with bated breath. But if you were like, here's five silhouettes and they're really vague and you can't tell who any of these characters are, buy our season pass! I'd be like, fuck you! Like, tell me who these damn characters are! Tell me who these characters are! Like, it's annoying. And yes, Big Red Couch is talking about how a lot of negativity behind DLC is when it's actual content that's cut from the game, and if it comes on the disc. Yeah, that is definitely a problem. There is a lot of issues with that. I was very against what they did with Street Fighter Cross Tekken. I was not happy about that at all. I was actually, really frustrated with that. Super Famicom says, or just make cheaper the game, right? So just make the game cheaper? No, you can't. And this is something that I covered a little bit earlier. It takes so much effort, it takes so much resources to create these games in the first place that it's not like if you want to make a smaller game, if you want to make 60% of the game, you don't develop 60% of the code, okay? If you make 60% of the game, as opposed to 100% of the game, you're probably going to develop like 90% of the code to create that 60%. And then the rest of the, to add that extra content is going to cost a lot less. Because everything that you're making from the get-go is all the systems, everything that your game is running off of, everything that's based off of, etc., etc., etc. Everything that you're developing to make the game work is like all in the first part, and that's where all the money comes from. So if you cut content, you can't make it any cheaper because you're not spending any less money. It's not taking any less time. That's why games are being made so goddamn long these days. That's why games do have these DLC, because then you've created this engine, you've created this game, and now you can get your money's worth out of it. So do I think in-game currency is the new DLC? Games like GTA 5, Overwatch, and SW Battlefront 2 have adopted that model instead. I don't like that model. I've been playing Final Fantasy Record Keeper on my phone for 2 years now, and I still haven't spent a single penny on it because I can't use my money to buy in-game money to buy in-game items. Like, that just doesn't work for my brain for some strange reason. But yeah, like, just to developers, stop doing that. Just tell us who the damn characters are. Even if you're not 100% sure, if you're still deciding who the eight characters in Dragon Ball are going to be, I'm sure you already know at least two of them. Tell us two of them. Just give us two of them. You know what I mean? Like, just throw us a bone. So Street Fighter comes out, just tell us all the characters. Like, when MVCI came out, I was actually kind of glad they told us Sigma and Black Panther were going to be DLC right away. Because then I was like, sick, I'm excited for Black Panther, so I'm going to buy the season pass because I want these characters. It made me buy a season pass early. Otherwise, I might not have wanted to buy a season pass, right? So, yeah, in those situations, in that situation, yes, totally justified for people not wanting to buy a season pass before they know what it's for. So my advice, again, is don't buy it. Don't buy it. And then also advice to devs, please just let us know what the hell is in that content. Please, please, please. And then again, the second point, which was, hey, they're giving us only a partial game and they're holding back instead of letting us, instead of waiting a year to finish the game and selling us the game with all 32 characters, I guess it's going to be, for $60, they purposely release only 3/4 of the characters, charge us a full $60, and then make us pay an extra $35. Yeah. But like I said, that's just a necessary evil these days, because I just don't know how to avoid that kind of a situation anymore, because games cost too much to make. And I don't know what the right answer to get around that kind of a problem is. Plus another thing too, and you know, I'm going to be biased here. Let me be a little bit of a shill. I'm not going to be a shill for what you think I'm going to be a shill for. I'm going to be a shill for Amazon.com, okay? Because Amazon.com already has it so that if you pre-order a game and you have Amazon Prime, you get the game for like, I think it's like 20% off. you already get like a discount off of it. So like all $60 games are $48 already. And if the price ever drops below that during the course of the pre-sale, you automatically get the lower price. I got Marvel vs. Capcom Infinite for $40. Okay, I pre-ordered it on Amazon, and I got it for $40. So I didn't even spend the $60 on the game. So I'm just saying, there are ways around this. There are ways around the $60 price for your games. What's going on, everybody who just joined into the chat? So, there is ways to mitigate the cost for it, right? And then also, the other thing you could do is just wait till the game comes out. Games go on sale pretty fast, it seems like, these days. So, so there's a lot of ways around it to try to mitigate the costs of a brand new game, etc., etc. So, let's see. More points that people have brought up was they were really mad that the Dragon Ball Premium Season Pass does not come with the Collector's Edition. I have no argument against that. I'm confused by that myself as well, because I've never seen a Collector's Edition not come with the Season Pass. So that is definitely a weird thing. Either the Goku statue or whatever that comes with the Collector's Edition is really fucking nice and not going to turn out to be six Easter eggs that you can't take out of the box at all. Or I don't know. Or it's just a weird decision. It's definitely a weird decision. I haven't been buying a lot of Collector's Edition, but the thing about it is you don't have to buy the Collector's Edition again. It's just something you don't have to do. And in fact, modern day sales is very much all Kickstarter based now. And I feel like that this needs to become a thing. Like, I just think all consumerism needs to go down the Kickstarter path, because we're at a point right now where we can market things through the web and everything. Because before, look, if you've taken an economics class, you know about supply and demand. Supply, demand, you find the middle point. This is the price that you make it, because then the people who really want it here and then the people who don't really want it would be more willing to buy it based off demand, etc., etc. That model is so fucking old and it's so outdated and it's so stupid that we don't actually need to do this. So we do not need to do this anymore. And so Kickstarter has proven that like a band will be like, hey, we're going to make this cool album, but we need your guys' help because we're a small indie band, but, you know, with fans. And for $200, you'll get all this cool stuff. For $50, you'll get all this stuff. Or you can just buy the album for $12 or $5 digitally. $12 gets you a physical copy. $25 will give you a poster. $50 will include a vinyl. $100, you'll have these autographed posters, etc. And the people who love the band to death, they buy the $200 tier stuff. Like, this is how I think all things should be, frankly. And I feel like everything should be this way. This has nothing to do with DLC now, but like, I feel like that this is the way it should work. So if you are really into Dragon Ball FighterZ and really into Dragon Ball and really into a Goku statue, just buy the Collector's Edition. If you don't want the Goku statue, then just buy the regular one and buy the Season's Pass. You'll live without the Goku statue. That's all I'm saying. That's all I'm saying. Yes, collectors are for surprise collectors. And interestingly enough, I've bought in so many collector's editions, and I think I might have like 8 boxes of collector's edition shit just sitting in the box. And I don't even know what the fuck to do with half of that shit. Like, I probably have bookends, and I probably have like posters and Street Fighter headbands and shit like that, and like these little display statues. I don't know what the fuck to do with any of that stuff. They're all just in boxes right now. So honestly, like, you know, the collector's editions are there for the collectors, honestly. So off topic, the Felicia statue, one of the stores that sponsored Wednesday Night Fights one time was selling it there. And I saw it, and I bought it from him. So, but that was when I had a job. That's when I had money. I could not buy that now anyways. And there's only 400 made as well, which is what this certificate says. So I have number 108 out of 400. So you cannot find the statue anymore at all. So, but yeah, you don't actually need to, you don't need to buy the collector's edition. So if you're mad at the season pass, doesn't come in the collector's edition, cancel your collector's edition pre-order, buy the regular edition, and then buy the season pass if you feel like it. Don't buy it right away. Wait. Spend $60 on the game. Or on Amazon, spend $48 on the game. Shoutouts to Jammed777 for the subscription. Much appreciated. Subscribing with Twitch Prime. Speaking of Amazon, do it. Dude, I need Felicia in MVCI so badly. She'd be the Wolverine function. She would 100% be the Wolverine function. But, sorry, I know, Jammed. Oh, what's up, Jammed? Yeah, really into MK. That was a whole nother topic from yesterday, and I was really confused about that. I was really confused about that whole thing, but I'll get into that in just a little bit. But basically, what was I saying? Yeah, you don't have to buy it. You don't have to buy the collector's edition, so just don't bother with it, right? And, you know, it sucks because I'd rather you buy the collector's edition because, you know, I'd like to have these games make money so that they can keep making it and feel like that they're worth it. You know, again, the game looks like it's made out of love, and MVCI obviously did not look that way. And here's the other thing. Here's another big thing, too. If you don't like that the way that all this deal stuff is going, despite me sitting here defending DLC and telling you all these good things about DLC, you know, you are absolutely, absolutely justified and absolutely in the right to vote with your wallet. Which is what happened with MVCI, right? A lot of people were not happy with Capcom's practices. That game didn't sell for crap, right? That game pretty much bombed, according to all the little things that I've heard from the NPD reports and from people who have said they've seen the numbers. The game apparently bombed. So people voted with their wallets. So now this is something that Capcom's got to understand. Unfortunately, in my opinion, that probably means we'll never see another Marvel vs. Capcom ever again in our lifetime. Because Marvel's going to be pissed about that. But at the same time, you know, maybe that's a good sign that they can put all their efforts into Street Fighter V and really get that game up to where it kind of needs to be right now. So definitely vote with your wallet. If you're not happy about these things, don't buy it. So a lot of the people who were responding to Namco like, well, you lost my money. That's absolutely their right. What I just don't want to see is a lot of negativity again. And this goes back to the negativity thing, which is ironic too, because I'll tell you this. I posted that as soon as the Dragon Ball stuff came out, I posted about DLC. And I was like, look, I know a lot of people are mad about this DLC situation with Dragon Ball, but look, DLC, here's the inflation logic, here's all this logic, here's all these little things that I talked about. And everybody's response to that was, well, honestly, James, I'm kind of mad about this. And then other people were like, well, you know what, James? You know, people were kind of mad about that kind of thing, etc., 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 right? And like, man, if I had said that about MVCI, I would have gotten flamed so badly. I would have had like 700 people telling me how shitty of a human being I am. Basically, they would have just all shit on me like crazy and being a shill and all this other stuff. But because it's for a game that they had hopes for, you know, obviously I'm not a shill for that game. But, you know, whatever, whatever. It's all good. It's all good. So, like I said, I'm sorry about rambling a little bit. I'm sorry about kind of going off topic a little bit. I meant for this to be a little bit more organized and everything like that. But, let me just give a really quick summary, really quick. Okay, so what is nice about DLC is that it is optional. If you want it, cool. If not, no problem. You're just going to have to make that choice. But with how much devs need to create from scratch when creating games, the poor devs can't really afford to make smaller games for peanuts. They have to milk it. It does suck, for sure. It's a whole unfortunate and a crappy situation. But rest assured, there are no winners, only losers. But yeah, I guess I am here to ramble. But you know what? That's kind of my summary in there. But I can guarantee you right now, someone is going to take that summary and they're going to like twist it up and they're going to cut it up and they're going to re-edit it and make this terrible thread about me being a shill or something like that. And they're going to try to make me sound a lot more mean than I actually am. In fact, In fact, I think I have a sample here. Look, I'm just going to show you exactly what's going to happen. Someone's going to create some new thread, basically talking about how I'm a shill and how I'm selling things out. And then all that's going to happen is there's going to be a clip to this right here. If you can't afford DLC, you're just poor and a loser. Suck. May nuts. A whole. Basically, that's what's gonna happen. They're gonna re-edit me and make me say something completely, completely different. So. And that's what's gonna happen, and I'm not gonna be happy about it. And that's all anyone's gonna actually see. That's all anybody is actually going to see, and I'm gonna be very, very sad about that. So, but yeah, that's kind of my rant on DLC. And I've gotta play that again, dude. I gotta play this again, dude. If you can't afford DLC, you're just poor and a loser. Suck. Maynuts. A whole. I think I oh man, sorry. I didn't I wanted to try to keep a straight face during that, but that thing makes me laugh, dude. It came out way better than I thought it was going to, but but in any case, that's kind of my take on DLC. If you guys want to ask any other questions or bring up any other topics, I'm willing to have some debates with people right now. So, let me know if you have any other questions, but before I do that, I am going to take a quick break. I'll be right back. And when I come back, I'll answer some questions from the chat about my opinion on some DLC stuff. So, I will be right back, guys. I'll be right back.
We should start from the first floor, okay? And, Jill, here's a lockpick. It might be handy if you, the master of unlocking, take it with you.
It's not just a poisonous snake, it's a monster!
My father will be satisfied! My father will be satisfied.
Oh God, where is this? Where is the terrible quote?
It looks like you chose the wrong party to crash.
My business is with Echigoya. Step aside, or I will have to kill you.
Oh yes, bad Asian accents.
It looks like you chose the wrong party to crash.
I have come for Echigoya, but I guess I have to deal with you first.
God! It's like they make all the bad guys talk with these horrible Asian accents, and all the heroes are all like perfect English accent, and they're all like trying to be hip.
My money! My money!
Where is my favorite one? This is the one that I quote when I play Breath of the Wild all the time. I'm trying to find it.
Please forgive my late arrival.
No, no. You have done well.
Oh yeah, I'm sure they were all voiced by Japanese people. Doesn't excuse it.
What? A little girl like you defeated my dear sister?
I just gave her a little lesson in manners. And you're next.
No. In today's lesson, you'll learn how a Myojin Soga master uses swords to avenge his sister.
I mean, it's basically like in the movie Memoirs of a Geisha, where they wrote lines as bad accent. At least when you see most films with people speaking with a bad accent, they write an English sentence and they say it with a bad accent because that's just their accent. But in a movie like Memoirs of a Geisha, they literally wrote bad accents. You are to become geisha. You are to become geisha. That's not a sentence, but that's what they made them say. You are to become geisha. Instead of like, you are going to become a geisha. Like, if they just spoke English and had an accent, okay. But you wrote bad grammar on purpose for them to say.
What is this, Bizenya? there is more here than usual.
We could not do business without you. The money is merely a token of our appreciation.
Jesus Christ!
Minister Kataoka should be safe for a while.
Diction, thank you. Where is it? Where? This gotta be here.
You shall die
by... Yes, this is... Oh, God, this one makes me so sick.
You shall die by my arrows.
Your arrows are like you, weak and twisted. I fear them, not...
You shall die by my arrows.
Your arrows are like you, weak and twisted. I fear them, not...
Oh, Tenchu Stealth Assassin, oh my god, you are the best. You are literally the best. Oh my god, I can go through this site for hours. Seriously, I will never get tired of this. I will never ever get tired of this site. Typing of the Dead, oh god. Oh, so great. Anyways, any questions that people have about DLC and stuff like that, if they have anything that they wanted to talk to me about. Oops. Oh, God. James the Powerhead, I will definitely watch that link just a little bit. Any other questions that people have? Do I prefer Capcom's current business practices to how they were in the mid-90s? I do, in a way, because like I said, I do like the fact that you can get characters through fight money. I like the fact that we get the DLC like this, because like I said, I bought 17 versions of like Street Fighter 2 and like 17 versions of Alpha and like 9 versions of CBS. I've bought so many Capcom fighting games in my time that the fact that, you know, Street Fighter 5 is only just going to be the one-time purchase with season passes, I'm okay with that, actually. I'm totally down with that. And so I'm okay with that kind of situation. Eli Hendricks, that is a... It's a Lilith Morgan statue. So there you go. It's a Lilith Morgan statue. With Lilith diving into Morgan's arms. And in front of it, I have Soul Bad Guy. So there you go. There was also a Kai Kisk that I wanted to get that I never ended up getting. But is top 5 game consoles ever? Well, that's a completely different question than I was expecting. I was meant about DLC, specifically about DLC. Is there any questions about DLC? Do I know the official number sales for MVCI? I heard it bombed even badly here in America. I heard it bombed really badly. It was 6th for the month of September, despite only having 2 weeks. Which sounded like it did way better than I thought it would, but Maximilian made a comment about it, and Mr. Wizard responded to it and said he had the numbers, and it definitely bombed. And just based on the fact that there's nobody playing it, you can't find anyone online, I'm pretty sure it bombed pretty badly, actually. Before you get started with serious ranting again, do you know why the recommended friends thing on Twitch is different now? You're in my list. I have no idea, actually. If X-Men were put in MVCI, what do you think they would look like, since MVCI is stepping away from the comic style for a cinematic style? You know what? I still think that they would look mostly like the X-Men. Really, the cinematic style is more lighting than anything, because the characters still are dressed kind of weird, right? Like, Captain Marvel doesn't necessarily look like a cinematic costume. Like, she still has, like, some of the alternate costumes are still very hero-esque and stuff like that. Even Hulk in a suit, right? Which just looks so sick, by the way. Hulk in a suit is, you know, very comic booky as well. So I don't think that the way they're making the characters look is more of a cinematic style. It's just the lighting. It's the terrible lighting that they've chosen for the game. I think that's where it causes a lot of the problems in there. The ankles are slowly bending under its own weight. Yes, actually, the answer is yes, but I have mitigated that. Because my Street Fighter V statue, the plate is actually sitting on a block on the front. So I actually have him leaning back a little bit, so he is actually resting on his heels. So the ankles are actually not bending. What would you say the best DLC practice a game had that you know of? In my opinion, right now, my favorite DLC has probably been something like Mario Kart 8, where the game came out and it clearly had exactly what every other Mario Kart game had in the past. And so when it came out, it was clearly extra content, and it was money that way that I felt was worth spending, because I love Mario Kart, and why wouldn't I want more tracks? So Mario Kart 8 was probably some DLC that I really liked. Other DLCs that, like, add story or, like give, like, legit content, I'm okay with. Do you think the industry was better before it was smaller teams making games? Now it's more corporate profit-induced. Yeah, easily. When I was talking about the fact that the middle-tier game developer has disappeared, that it's only indie and it's only AAA now, and this part disappeared, I guess I didn't really emphasize enough how much I'm lamenting that portion right there. That is the crux. That is video games right there. Because indie games, you have a lot of limitations, and people are suffering to make those games. I don't want people to suffer to make games, okay? And then the AAA title, you have to just basically fucking go nuts and spend $250 million on game development and marketing and budgeting and all this shit like that. And that's garbage, because that's what causes all this problem, the DLC problems. Piracy is another problem. It's all feeding into itself, because the used game market exists because games are so expensive. Piracy exists because the games are so expensive. But used game market and piracy causes people to have to charge more for games, because they're losing money on those things. So it's this vicious cycle. The video game industry, I feel like, is going to explode at some point in time. I don't know if we'll ever reach an Atari 2600 level of death and destruction to the video game industry that required the Nintendo Entertainment System to rebirth the video games. I don't know if people are even aware of this, but before the Nintendo Entertainment System came out, video games were pretty much dead. Like, there were no video games. Like, people didn't care. They were super niche. Because the Atari 2600 came out, and I fucked everything up, because everybody could make a game. So you had games like Custer's Revenge, which was a porn game on the Atari 2600. People would make games that basically didn't work on the 2600. There was no quality control, which is why the Nintendo Entertainment System actually had the seal of approval, the quality seal of approval, because every game had to at least go through Nintendo before it was officially released. That way they wouldn't end up with crazy, stupid games like that, like pirated games and everything like that. So, the problem with it now is that everything is too expensive to make. And I just feel like we're not getting those middle-level quality of games anymore, and that is where the best games came from. In fact, most of the time, it's those middle-level games that are the greatest games. And AAA titles, there's just too much expectation out of them, and they're bloated, they don't feel right. And like, even like, for example, like, people have told me how much Uncharted is great. I played Uncharted 1 and 2. I didn't really like them. I know, blasphemy, but like, it's just, I don't know if it was because it's a AAA and I was expecting more out of it, etc., etc. But like, you have a game like Uncharted and it's just all cinematic. And like, I fucking went to a Tetris tournament. Like, I don't need story, you know? Like, I want a great game to play, and we're missing that now. Games are trying too hard to be movies, which is why they gotta get Hollywood voice actors and cinematic scores and shit like that. I don't fucking care about cinematic scores. Give me fucking video game music, okay? Give me fucking video game music. I hate video game music that disappears into the background. That is shit, okay? I want video game music to stand out to me. I want it to stand out to me. What do I think about 24 characters rumored roster for Dragon Ball FighterZ? Too small for 3v3? No, not at all, not at all. I think that's fine. I think people have overinflated their expectations for things. MVC2 kind of ruined expectations because there was 56 characters in that game. But keep in mind, only 6 of them are new, and all of them were reused sprites, reused audio, reused sounds. So, and then MVC3 was kind of an exception as well, having as many characters as it did. Like, honestly, I think 30 for MVCI is a huge amount of characters. And I think 24 for Dragon Balls as a brand new game, and knowing how hard it is to make that game, because I know what goes into making those Guilty Gear style games, I think that's fine. I think 24 is absolutely fine. So Rillian 2MK asks, do you know anything about how they contract the voice actors for, like, Injustice? They do a lot of character-specific interactions. I'm guessing they have 100 characters that they think that they might put in the game, and when they come in to record them, they just record them saying everything, and they've written dialogue for every single one of them. Honestly, that's probably the way they've done it. So you'll probably have someone having dialogue with a character like Liu Kang and Johnny Cage, and then also this other obscure DC character, Martian Manhunter, you know, Lobo, let's bring back these. They probably have them talking to everybody. They just probably have a shit ton of dialogue out there that they've recorded ahead of time, and a lot of them probably won't go into use. That's my guess. That's my guess how it works. Somebody else here can actually clarify on that as well. DiCaprio. You want DiCaprio? Oh, man. Who is my waifu? I mean, my waifu is kind of by default Cammy, just because she's basically the character I'm associated with. She's my favorite character. Like, I have like, Cammy art is on my wall, you know, my phone homepage, my home wallpaper, etc., etc. I've never been into Cammy for looks or anything like that. I've never been like, oh my god, Cammy's so hot. Oh, Cammy! You know, like, that's not... Like, if I had to have an actual waifu status in that factor, I've always said that my main video game waifu... I don't really have a main video game waifu. Quistis, maybe, in Final Fantasy VIII. I always thought she was hot, but I just like chicks with glasses, which is why if Android 21 is not playable, I will be mad. I'll be so mad. I'll be so mad. What do I think about a free-to-play model for fighting games? I think it would work. It would just be very, 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 very tricky to do. It would be very, very tricky to do. And you know, DOA has tried it. KI has tried it. Rising Thunder was going to try it. So I think it could work. I think it could work. We can do DLC. Oh, I'm leaning towards Q&A questions about DLC right now. Do I like the F-Zero series? Oh, whatever, fuck it. It's Q&A. It's just whatever question you feel like asking now. What do I like F-Zero? F-Zero on the GameCube is probably one of my favorite games of all time. That game was fan-fucking-tastic. My God. The thrill and the zoning out and the amazing just emotional experience of playing that game and racing those tracks with the backgrounds. I would just go into trial mode and just race tracks with no opponents going in circles for hours, because it was just, it just, driving in that game was such a thrilling feeling. Do you think the constant release of DLC ruins game balance? No, it depends. I mean, if it's Kokonoe, yes. But, like, for example, Capcom has been very safe with Street Fighter V characters so far, so I think it's working out so well. I think it's working out well right now. Why is SF5 model so criticized when it's the only fighting game to have the option of using in-game currency, or am I wrong? I think most people are okay with it. I think people just don't like it because they feel like Street Fighter V kind of set this weird standard for season passes and stuff like that. And I think a lot of people are just mad because they just don't like the characters that are coming out. Witcher started with a small mid-team, okay. Who's the best table flip character in fighting games? It would be Zangief, because he's the only one that I can remember that has a table flip. For clarity, examples of fighting games by mid-tier developers, please. Tuning in just now. I would say something like TMNT Fighters, probably Melty Blood, Uniel. There were a lot of mid-tier fighting games at first. And some of them actually were surprisingly good. But a lot of those games started that way. Melty Blood started out as a fan-made fighting game, and it just got picked up and got a lot of steam and got bigger than that, and then it produced Uniel, etc., etc. Do you think the leaked SF5 AE battle mode costumes are a nod on what's to come to MVCI as DLC? I mean, there'll be an Asura costume on SF. You know what? I have no idea. Like, you know, I bet you they don't even think that far ahead. Not that I'm trying to discredit Capcom, but I really don't think that they're thinking that far ahead. 2600 was a great console, MJ Fan 80s. It's a pretty shitty console in retrospect because you can't play any of those games really for a very extended amount of times. But at the time, God, what a fucking great console. Lei Wulong, is he coming to Tekken 7 anytime soon? Lord Eris was commenting in a tournament, said, still no Lei, right next to a guy who works for Tekken, and he was quiet as fuck. I need Lei Wulong in my life. I have no idea. All I know is Geese is coming, and there's supposed to be, like, another guest character or something like that, but that's all I know. That's all I know. Why doesn't Tetris have a story mode? Really, Mr. Friday? You know, they actually tried to greenlight a Tetris the movie at one point in time, and I'm super mad about that. Like, the irony of the video game industry mirroring our economy is rich. The poor developers re-suffering the middle tier income is wiped out, and the rich are fat and happy. This is absolutely true. And there's a lot of problems with this. And it's because... this is why I think that the video game industry is going to blow up at some point in time. I feel like some bubble is going to burst for the video game industry. Because it can't keep continuing like this. We can't just only have indie and AAA titles. Because and I know there's a lot of things fighting it. Steam is doing a lot of work to fight against these kind of things. You know, indie game development is doing a lot to fight against these things. But... they just don't have the same budget, and eventually they're going to get swallowed up by these big companies, especially if EA or Blizzard or whoever keeps buying these companies and then shuttering them right away. Like, that's just not good. Well, indie games have become popularized from consoles becoming digitally downloaded in Steam, so any indie game presenting potential, they are being picked up and financially backed and becoming no longer indie quality as in terms as an indie game. Yeah, hopefully. How did Super Mario Bros. 2 not kill the gaming industry? Back then, there wasn't much choice, and not only that, but that just shows you how powerful Nintendo was back then. Very first Nintendo Power issue was Super Mario 2, and they marketed the hell out of that game. They marketed the hell, and even as me, as a person with, I've told my Super Mario 2 story on stream before, I should have hated that game, because that game turned me into a fucking liar, but, I still enjoyed that game. How should Super Mario Odyssey handle DLC? I don't know how the game plays. If it's like stages and worlds, like Super Mario 64, they could just add new worlds from time to time. I think that would be fine. Peter asks, imagine if it was technically capable for Arxis to create alternate costumes for Guilty Gear. You bet your ass everyone and their mother would be willing to pay $8 for them. Yeah, I mean, they're selling voices already. Like, you can buy voice people to say the menus. Like, that's what they're selling right now. I think you might be able to fish some of those out, but you can buy them right away. You can buy all the colors and everything like that. So they are definitely trying to milk it as much as they possibly can. So, what do you mean, Olaf? What do you mean you know me? You know me about what? Let's see. Another waifu that I had would probably be Kyoko from Rival Schools. Do I think the Riot fighting game will save the industry? If Riot is making a fighting game, which everyone just assumes they are because they grabbed the Radiant, the Rising Thunder group, if they are making a fighting game, it's going to be very interesting because they can do a lot of things with the game and they have the ability to try a lot of things that other people can't. Such as a free-to-play model. And if it is a League of Legends fighting game, then a lot of fighting game players who do play League of Legends will already be familiar with the characters, and League of Legends is so big that other people will hear like, oh, there's a League of Legends fighting game, and then automatically assume quality or something. There's a lot of potential with that, and if it came out, it might not save the industry as opposed to completely dominate the industry. You want Cody back? True story, Swaggenheimer. He wasn't even supposed to be in Alpha 3. He was supposed to be Joe from Street Fighter 1. That's why he's in the prison gear. That's why he's associated with all the Street Fighter 1 motif in the background and everything like that in his Alpha 3 background. They even paid homage to that in Street Fighter 4 because Cody punches through the Street Fighter 1 title screen. But he was supposed to be Joe, not Cody. I am a high-class man. Thank you, James, the Powerhead. Thank you. Do you know what effect Steam sales have on the profits for game publishers? Are the high numbers enough to offset the much lower prices? I don't know. Actually, I'd have to do research on that, Suburban Socrates. I actually don't know that well enough. Play ST on Fight Cave. I probably should. Final Fantasy 7 or 8? Oh, 8 free. 8 for free. Overrated fighting games you have played. Third Strike. Most underrated fighting game. That's always a hard one to say because there's a lot of great fighting games out there. Oh, shout outs to Darude Boy for the cheer. Let's see. I'll read his message in just a... Let me get over here. I missed the whole message there. Unio, actually, yeah, Unio was probably one of them as well. Darude Boy says, dude, I just tuned in and you're already talking about one of my favorite games of all time, Rising Thunder. Have these bits, sir. Okay, there you go. I think GameStop has contributed to the industry change in video games, which are positive and negative, because they forced the evolution of the industry by reselling used games and making a $4 billion a year and not sharing a red cent with the developers, and why consoles went digital and DLC. Because, yeah, look, don't get me started on GameStop. I could rant about GameStop all day. I fucking hate them, but that's a whole other story. It's a whole other story. Do you feel that people who complain about balance in Street Fighter V, specifically for Balrog and Laura, for example, are generally people who understood ST? My experience and understanding of ST is that you can't possibly play ST and like it and complain about those things in Street Fighter V. Could be, to be honest with you. But the reason why you complain about those characters... See, the reason why ST is not as bad is because every character was kind of oppressive. In a way, it was just different varying degrees of oppressiveness. But Laura and Balrog are, like, specifically oppressive in a game where many of the characters are not oppressive. Maverico asked, I like it when I can see what I'm buying. Season passes are like loot boxes. Yeah, and exactly. But the nice thing about them is that you have no pressure to buy them. I've mentioned that a lot already on this stream already. Just make sure that you don't buy the season pass. Wait till you find out what's in them, because unlike a loot box, you can find out what's in them before you buy it. Would Undernight and Birth be mid-tier developers? Yes, probably. Why is Skullgirls so niche? I think it has a lot to do with the art style. I think it has a lot to do with just the way that the gameplay is designed. The gameplay is very scary. It's simplified a lot, but early on the game came out, the combos were very long, the game is very complex. Just the call assist and everything like that, having to hit diagonal buttons and then hit like two, like every button combination that exists on a joystick is something in Skullgirls. And I just think that the game is kind of intimidating to play a little bit, and it's very reset heavy. And unfortunately, I just think that there's just a stigma associated with it just because of the art style of it. What is my TMNT Tournament Fighters tier list? I don't really have one, to be honest with you. I just remember that I abused the hell out of Moron Crusher with Shredder. And I remember that Asuka was really cheap because she just hit you with her ass all day or something. I forgot what we called her, like Asuka. I can't remember what we called her. Bravo from Chaos Code has a table flip super and a table set special. Azrael flips the ground as if it were a table... In Astral, Chun stage in 3S gives you a table to destroy a few more, probably. Okay. I never thought about it that deeply. Top 5 worst fighting game OSTs you have heard of all time. Would take me too long to think about that. When am I going to play Nier Automata? I don't know. Do you want Mokujin back in Tekken 7? Not really. Who did I play in Vampire Savior? I played Bishamon, Felicia, and Anna Karras, mostly. What were the greatest fame for Sega Saturn? And what were the greatest games for Sega Saturn? X-Men vs. Street Fighter, because I played the hell out of that. Night Warriors, because I played the hell out of that. Radiant Silver Gun, because that game was fucking amazing. I like Tetris. Main Hero is not white. It promotes Mori Kudra. Well, I don't know. The long piece is white, usually, most of the time. So, dude, I'm falling so behind. Kickstarters have evened it up. Look at Divinity Original Sin. Out of games that have a different Japanese title than Western title, what series game do you think has the best Western title? Not better than the Japanese, just better Western title over others that had different... Jesus Christ! These are complicated questions! Holy crap! Metroid 4 is coming. Are you hype? What? Did they really announce a Metroid 4? Way too much money is used on marketing these days. FF15 marketing budget was ridiculous. Yeah, but like, that's kind of what you have to do now, because there are so many goddamn games and there's a lot of good ones out there, and people don't have enough time to play all of them. So you have to make them decide. And so if you have the budget to try to influence people in your way, yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. If it were ever to happen, would you rather have Namco Bandai or Arxis buy out Capcom? I would rather have Arxis buy out Capcom, because then Arxis would make Darkstalkers. Worst fighting game OSTs? Oh, yeah, again, I don't have to think about that too much. If the talk about Capcom being in serious financial trouble is true and they are looking for a buyout, who would you prefer to be the one to pick them up? If it wasn't between Namco and Arxis, I don't know. Can you show a new fighting game coming from Namco Bandai? It's called Seven Deadly Sins. I heard about that, I think. Who will be the second Tekken DLC character? Geese, right? Or is Geese the first? Because Elise is the first. Geese is the second, right? Geese is the character. GameStop is publishing now, too? Jesus Christ. You live with Justin. How many hours he trained per day? Hey. Justin lived with me. Okay, get that straight. And he actually didn't practice that much, which was shocking, because he's really fucking good for not practicing all that much. Can you show a vid of new fighting game? Maybe on Tuesday show we'll do that. So if you play competitive, you don't have a choice to buy passes, though. Need to test stuff out. That is true. But if you're also competitive, you probably would have bought the season passes anyway, right? The style and pixel animation in Third Strike is top-notch. Absolutely. Very, very good. I can see how Skullgirls is scary, but people get hyped over MVCI, and the art style is not like it's Melty Blood or all those. Because MVCI is also characters that you recognize. It's Captain America. It's Magneto Function. It's Captain Marvel, Hulk, those kind of characters. Skullgirls, like I said, I think the stigma around it was that it was all female characters, and very early on, like, the characters, you know, had a lot of, you know, like, I'll just say it, like, upskirts kind of stuff and things like that, and they're all, like, bizarrely busty and things like that. So I think there was just a stigma associated with the game, unfortunately, that kind of drove people away, unfortunately, that were not like that, more people might have actually played it. I don't know. When are you doing Varudanya? Maybe tonight. Virtua Fighter 2 is a great game, but God did I suck at that game. What is my favorite SNK game? I don't know. I actually don't really know, to be honest. You have to think about it. So they are making a Prime 4, huh? Metroid Prime 4? They're actually making a new one? Fusion is... Metroid Prime 4 Fusion is Metroid 4. I don't know. I did not know about Metroid 4, no. Do I eat ass? Ask Infiltration that question. So ask him what I said about that. If Capcom sold out certain IPs to the highest bidder, who would you pick up for Breath of Fire? I'd want Arxis to pick up Darkstalkers. Breath of Fire, I'm not sure. I don't know anything about Breath of Fire. It's a legacy series of the community. I just think Skullgirls is so well made, it makes me sad. Yeah, it does. And it's made with a lot of love, too. And Mike Z is a very, very smart man, and he has done some great stuff with that game. And the amount of balancing work that and dedication that he has had to that game has been tremendous. I'm really sad he wasn't rewarded as much as he could have, but they have definitely sold, like, a million copies, like, through Steam or something like that. So they definitely have done enough. So, hey, I love Third Strike. What don't you like about it? New characters, balance, parry? I hate parries. And the game is unbalanced as fuck. That game is the most unbalanced Street Fighter game since Champion Edition. How do commentators remember so many moves and frame data? Do you have to study a lot? You just get used to it a lot of the times. And I'm for me personally, I'm just starting to not worry about the exact numbers. In fact, if you actually watch a series of videos that I made talking specifically about frame data, I talk about why you don't have to memorize the numbers. You just memorize categories of moves. This one's minus, this one's safe, this one's plus, this one's punishable, you know, et cetera, et cetera. Shout outs to Schifferbrains, 562 for becoming an general in the Chen Dynasty. What was worse in arcades, Mace the Dark Age or War Gods? War Gods only because they had a 3D button that had a light under it that made the button really hot. So when you hit the button, you could almost burn your hand sometimes. Is Darkstalkers 4 a game I want? Yes and no. Because if they made it, it would probably never live up to anything that the original Darkstalkers were. I would only trust Darkstalkers 4 if it was made by me. We get a new Soul Calibur sometime down the road. I heard there's rumors about it. What is my cereal tier list? My favorite cereal is Lucky Charms. That's all I can say right now. Thoughts on commentators not using the proper names for each character and use journal terms like DP, Rekka, SPD. That saves so much time and so much energy. Like, I do that all the time. And I think it's the right... I don't think you should be mad at any commentator for not saying the actual move names. That's way too much. I don't want to sit here and fucking say, oh, Nikola did Disc of Guidance. Like, the fuck does that mean? He did the charge. It's like, it's good enough. It's good enough. Am I going to see Thor Ragnarok or Justice League? I'll probably see both. Although I haven't seen any of the other DC movies. I haven't seen Suicide Squad, Dark Knight, Man of Steel, Batman, Superman. I mean, I've seen Dark Knight. I haven't seen all the DCCU stuff, so, because I've heard all of it sucks, so. Have you ever played Shaq Fu? How about Rama 1/2, Eternal Champions? I have not played Shaq Fu. I have played Street Combat, and I played a little bit of Eternal Champions. Eternal Champions was during the prime time of my pro-Nintendo, anti-Sega period, so I hated Eternal Champions. Street Combat is a travesty to what Rama 1/2 was supposed to be. What's my take on the indecent amount of outsourcing that's happening nowadays in fighting games? It can be good or bad. It depends. MVCI was, I think, in-house, whereas Street Fighter 4 was DIMPS or something like that. So, you know, it can go either way. It definitely can go either way. What do I think is the point of the Street Fighter character poll, since characters already in the game are in the list? I have no idea. Will Taekwondo tape measure tech make me godlike at fighting games, Dead Richard? Absolutely. Your mileage may vary, asterisk. Thoughts on Fantasy Strike. I really have not had a chance to play it, but I like what it's trying to do. I've heard from a lot of people that they really like the game and that there's a lot of cool things about it. And I like the stuff that Serlin said, is that there's nothing in between games like Dive Kick and like other fighting games. Like, there's nothing right there. There's nothing that's simple to play but has like the kind of mind games and stuff like that. Even Rising Thunder kind of skewed a little bit towards the side because it had one frame links. So he's trying to make that game that is actually mix up heavy but easy to control and a little bit more, you know, less execution heavy. And while I do not think that execution should be taken out of fighting games, if a game is designed around that concept and has that particular goal, I have no qualms about it. So I think Fantasy Strike has a lot of potential. Is it true that Daigo was influenced by Alex Vai to play Ryu in SFA3? Yes, that is true. Vai was the one who almost beat Daigo's Akuma the first time they played against each other. So that actually kind of got him to play. NDO103, thank you for becoming a general in the Chen Dynasty. Na 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 na. Okay, top three characters I want in Street Fighter V and MVCI. God, you just limit it to one. I want Sodom in Street Fighter V, and in MVCI, I want Felicia. The average viewer may not know every move name, but can we at least have commentators say Hadouken instead of Hadouken? Or... Hadouken, oh, you're saying, but Hadouken, I mean, that's how they say it in game. Hadouken! 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 Who do I want in Season 3 for Street Fighter 5? I just said Sodom. What are your thoughts on the Battle of the Stones, and which one is your favorite? I mean, it's like David said, they just need to make it a lot more specific on what's going on. Do I enjoy beat-em-ups? Do you think Capcom would profit in trying to revive the genre? I do enjoy beat-em-ups, actually. I love TMNT, the arcade. I love X-Men arcade game. Streets of Rage 2 is a fan-fucking-tastic game as well. I don't think Capcom needs to redefine them. A lot of companies could do that. How do I feel about the changes Soul Calibur 5 did to the roster and mechanics? What would you want in Soul Calibur 6? I am not familiar with Soul Calibur at all. Remember, Tekken 7 is my first 3D game. I don't know much about Soul Calibur at all, so I am not qualified to answer that. First thing you would balance in Mario Kart 8, I would fucking kill blue shells! What do you think is happening with Capcom in terms of artists? It seems that the art direction is lacking a lot of personality and quality with everything they do apart from Street Fighter V. For example, MGCR and you, Puzzle Fighter. Yeah, I'm not sure. I bet you with Puzzle Fighter, they probably outsourced it to, like, mobile artists because they just made the characters look like mobile characters, so I think that they just felt like they've had to appeal to the mobile market by, like, making it look all like Clash of Clans and whatever like that. MGCR, I don't know what the hell happened, to be honest. I'm sad about that. I mean, obviously they had people there who could fix Chun-Li's face, and if they could fix Chun-Li's face, hopefully they can fix a lot more than that at some point in time. So, with optimization to Unreal Engine 4 and 2 frames less of input lag, do you think going under 4 frames of input lag will affect online play? Maybe, but you know what? That's not going to happen for any of the games anytime soon. So don't worry. So it's not going to happen. You can't change the underlying engine of your game. It's too dangerous. Cammy's dive kick being consistent no matter the angle you hit the enemy would make her broken? Yeah. Cammy's dive kick... The tricky thing about Cammy's dive kick... Dive kicks are just a problem in general. They're either useless or they're too good. So the fact that Cammy has to aim it right now to make it plus or safe, I think is fine. I think Cammy's dive kick in Street Fighter V is actually probably one of the most... actually more properly designed dive kicks in a long time. Wasn't Virtua Fighter your first 3D game? Okay, I did try to play Virtua Fighter 2, but like I said, I sucked and I never understood it. I never understood what the 3D game was about the concept of taking turns and being conscious about frame data and all that stuff like that. So even though I was playing Virtua Fighter 2, I was not playing a 3D game. I was playing a 2D game in Virtua Fighter. So I was never that good at it. So Splatterhouse was a great game. Dude, Splatterhouse is a great game. Okay, I think I just caught up to all the questions here. Woo! Let me ask you guys this question. I was going to ask you guys a question. I was going to ask everyone in the chat a question. I forgot what I was going to ask, but shoutouts to Moragai for becoming a general in the Chen Dynasty. Do you think Capcom will nerf Tokido by nerfing Akuma like they did Infiltration with Nash? I hope not. I mean, I saying that myself, not repeating what you said. What about her V-skill? Would make it faster or have better invincibility make her broken? I don't think so. I would nerf some other things if you made her V-skill better. But her V-skill is just useless. It's so stupid. It's so boring. Like, I would have rather them made her V-skill like the hooligan or something like that. And then, like, give her a bunch of... I don't know. I just fucking... They never figured out how to make Cammy's spin knuckle work. They've never done it. They've just never been able to figure out how to make it work. Here's a question that will blow my socks off. When you wash your socks, where does the odd sock go? It actually gets sucked into the edge of the dryer machine and gets caught inside and actually starts becoming a giant pile of socks inside the machine. They've proven this because at one household, the socks began, they sat there for so long that they became sort of sentient after a while, and they started crafting their own plot to take over the machine. They started breeding, and there was a bunch of little socks, and eventually all the socks kind of gathered up, and they tore apart the machine, and they destroyed half of a house. But fortunately, the owner, like, burned the house down before the socks caused any problems, and that was the last of that. And so now they design drying machines with sock poison inside the dryer machine, so when the socks do get sucked into the edge, they instantly breathe in the sock poison and they never have a chance to become sentient and gain life. So, back in your day, when I was competing, how did you guys communicate? Did you guys use, like, frame data talk, or was the move just plus or minus language? I'm just curious. We didn't have any language. It was like, you just knew a move was punishable. That move's not safe. That's all you said. Did you see that someone made an Abigail nude mod? Good for them. Good for them. That family socks were revolting. Nice. Are you reading the Street Fighter vs. Dark Soccer Udon comic? I am not, actually. Why is Testament not in Guilty Gear Xrd Rev 2? Story-wise, I think he, like, retired or something like that. Yeah, man, people don't even understand how much of non... I mean, Vi said something that was actually... I really agree with a lot. There's a lot of people these days... I know there's a... That's what I wanted to ask. I remember now. There's a lot of people talking about this esports thing and how they hate esports and it's killing the FGC. And Vi has been kind of, you know, being a voice against it on social media. And one of these things that he said that I really do agree with, and, you know, I brought it up myself during the streams where I talked about, you know, Street Fighter V dying and the FGC dying, et cetera, is that the people who say they don't want fighting games to go esports or that they don't want it to succeed, they just like the grassroots, have really kind of been shitting on what people have been trying to build up in the last 20 years. And it's true, because, like, for us, like, 20 years ago, man, we could only dream it could be like this. And now that it is like this now, it's, like, awesome. It's amazing. And we love it. And it's not even just for us to have a profit or anything like that. It's just because people are able to appreciate our skill now. Before, when you played in an arcade, only the people in the arcade knew you were any good. And that kind of sucked. But now to be able to say that I'm the best in the world and legit say I'm the best in the world and have other people have debates about whether you or somebody else are the best in the world, that kind of stuff is cool. It's cool. It's fun. It's great. And yeah, I mean, like, I don't want to lose our personality. I don't want to clean up for esports and all that stuff like that. Like I said, I don't want to go esports. I want... to go FGC. I want FGC to maintain what FGC has been doing. FGC to stay FGC. I don't want anything to go in that direction. So I want us to grow. I want us to be a successful industry. I do not want us to lose our personality. I don't want FGC to become... I don't have to have the... I'm not. My goal is not for the FGC to become some billion-dollar industry, okay? I just want to make it so that people can actually comfortably do it as a career. And we're in the best position to do that out of all the esports, as me and David were talking about yesterday. So wanting to go esports has nothing to do with money or trying to be rich or whatever, all that kind of stuff. It's just being able to have players dedicate time to this, to do something that they love and know that they're not ruining their lives, to know that they are not destroying their lives. Because players like Punk and Knuckledew can be as good as they are because they know they can win money doing this stuff. Right, so that gives them more reason to play harder. And some people say the money has made people play softer, but I mean, it's hard to say, really, to be honest with you. Because without the money, we wouldn't have guys like Sonic Fox killing everybody, right? Because his parents obviously didn't approve of it at first. Now they're like, this is great. You've gotten you paid for your college with Mortal Kombat and Injustice. So, you know, like, we wouldn't know about that kind of level of play. And yeah, esports, there are definitely bad sides about it. There's no question about that. When I went to the Tetris tournament, it was great to see how grassroots it was. But at the same time, I wanted to grow into something bigger. They all wanted to grow. Seeing the Tetris community this last weekend was like seeing what the fighting game community was like 10 years ago. Just a lot of very hopeful people working their asses off on a day job and doing this on the side. Just, I mean, like, one of the player, Yanni from Finland, like, literally has said, like, he just plays all day in, like, he shouldn't do this, but, like, he doesn't really eat, he doesn't sleep, he just plays Tetris all day, you know? Like, that's how much he's into it. And there's all these players that are just so passionate about this game. And seeing how it was, I mean, that's how fighting games were. And they wanted to get bigger. And so basically, imagine going up to those guys and telling people, no, fuck you guys, it should stay grassroots because esports sucks. And they would all look at you and be like, what? I mean, they all kept coming up to me and they're like, James, How do other esports do this? How do esports do this? How do esports do that? Do you think this would seem more esports? And I was like, dude, you guys are like way above anything that we're doing in the fighting game community right now. They were doing some sick ass shit. But, you know, that kind of passion there, like, that's why they want that kind of thing. And that's why, in my opinion, I still would like us to get bigger and become a professional kind of thing. Again, we can control it because we have the power right now. We can make sure that we do how we want to. Sure, there's the situation where ESPN has said, you know what, you can't use those costumes. But that is a road bump, you have to understand. Because we need to get on ESPN so that more people become aware of it, so that it becomes more legit, so that you can say to people, we're on ESPN, so that makes investors care. And as that happens, then the FGC grows, and then the FGC can then say, screw you, ESPN, because we're bigger than ESPN at that point. A lot of people don't understand. It's the whole concept of having to spend money to make money, right? So that's why I always say, like, all the other communities, we have to kind of hope Street Fighter gets big so that we can overthrow it. Like, that's kind of the same concept. You have to give a little to be able to take a little bit more, basically. So, so I have completely ignored the chat for a very long time. What would you like to see to happen to Claw in Season 3? I want him to have... make it so that he cannot combo his super after the Rose anymore. And I would like his Rose to be a one bar V trigger. So that he can throw Roses out a lot more. Do I agree that Cammy looks so much better with camo on her legs? I don't know. I've never really thought about that. Favorite Zelda game and why? Majora's Mask. Majora's Mask, because it's one of the greatest artistic games ever made. I had no idea online play would exist 20 years ago, let alone making money off of playing video games. I don't think anyone realized that online wasn't a thing and having to spend money to play games added higher stakes. Yeah, it's very different. I heard you were a programmer before. What did you program in? Ever thought about developing games? I was started with C++, then moved mostly to Java, then eventually to C#. I have thought about programming in games, but to be honest with you, I was a good programmer. I wasn't a great programmer, so I don't know if that is... I mean, I was a good programmer. I was a very, very functional programmer. I enjoyed it. I liked it, but I just wasn't at that degree that you see some programmers who are just, they are fucking geniuses with the shit, and they are so exceptional. And when I was at my job towards the end, I could feel my drive for it waning a little bit. And so I'm a good programmer, but I don't know if that's where my future was intended to be. And I've always done the most practical thing. So when I lost my job, I decided to do something completely impractical, which is do commentary for a living. And like I said, it's not even working, right? I'm technically in the red, but I have enough savings that I can survive on that. So I'm able to do it for a while. So I'm just going to see how it goes. I'm just going to live my life trying to enjoy myself for a little bit and see how that goes. So is there anything you want to say to Mike Ross right now? Yes, Mike Ross, call me. Let's hang out for lunch, dude. I haven't seen you in a while. I haven't talked to you in a while. I just want to just hang out. I'm not going to ask you how you're doing or whatever. Like, I just want to hang out and talk because I've always liked hanging out and talking with you, Mike Ross. Playing for money is only 1% of the player base. Doesn't esports help the TOs more? No, not really. Because the reason why is because the more esports makes it so more people watch. The more people watch, the more people care. The more people care, the better the sponsors are. The better the sponsors are, the more money there is. So it helps the TOs and the players. We'll get to a point where we're not just paying top 8. We'll get to a point where we're paying top 32 once we get bigger prize money so that the people down there can also survive as well. So there's a lot of potential. And besides, you can also be a sponsored player even though you place top 8. But never win, right? You can still be sponsored. So sponsors will come in more likely if the FGC grows bigger, etc., etc. It's all a numbers game, and everything is done through advertising and sponsors. That's always the number one way that anything like this is actually going to succeed. Um, People need to stop conflating game quality with esports. People just want better games. Yeah, that's true. If you could choose one character to put in Street Fighter V, who would you choose between El Fuerte and El Fuerte? I would choose not El Fuerte. What do you think of Zeku? Is he any good? I don't know yet, but I liked what Ice said on social media. He said he feels like Zeku is in preparation for Season 3, which might be less V-trigger focused and more footsie-based. So if he's kind of designed with Season 3 in mind, that might be a good thing. So basically, FGC needs to become more like Barstool Sports. Maybe. I mean, it just needs to be something that people want to go and watch. And which is why when I do commentary, I talk about people all the time. I talk about personalities more. I talk about mindsets, mentality. I talk about what Mena RD is thinking in between matches and stuff like that. Because that, to me, is the most important thing. You want to know, you want to have empathy for the players. You want to get behind the players. The players are the most important things. They're the things that are going to attract people, not the commentators, not the games. It's the players. You can see Justin, no matter what game he plays, people will have a certain thing to think about Justin because of his history, because he's Justin Wong. If you went to play Tekken 7, people would have an opinion about him in Tekken 7 because he's Justin Wong. It's the people, it's the players, the personalities who are the most important thing. You getting Mario Odyssey? I am getting it, and I'm hyped. Top 5 Super Mario games ever. I actually really loved Super Sunshine. I'm not gonna lie. So my favorite was probably like 3, then maybe World and Sunshine or something like that. Is Zeku any good? No idea. What's my favorite version of Tetris? That's a tough question. Because I have not really sat down to do Grandmaster as much as I want to. Playing for my, do I have a foot fetish? Yes. Haha. Ballerina Toshinden versus DXerd? I don't know what the hell that means. I don't know what DXerd is. Do you have the chance to test Puzzle Fighter Mobile? I have not played it yet. When I hear esports, I think online tournaments, which I disagree with. But I'm more than happy to see games broadcasted and shown more and more people. Yep. If you become a major pro player tomorrow, which game would I focus on? I would focus on... maybe Tetris. If it had to be a fighting game, I would probably do Street Fighter just because I probably have the best chance to succeed in that game. Because I'm not going to be successful in Marvel or Tekken or Injustice at the state that I'm at, or Guilty Gear. I would probably have the best chance to become a good player in Street Fighter, so that's probably what I would have to do. If you thought about branding UCTV to sponsors or creating basic UCTV merch to sell to your fans to help income, I've thought about it. Would people actually want to buy Ultra Chen TV merchandise or even Chen Dynasty merchandise? If I could play one console for the rest of your life, what would it be? Probably the Super Nintendo or the regular Nintendo? Actually, I might have to cheat and say something like the Wii U or something like that, because it would have a lot of the new games and all of the virtual console games, so I could play all those games too. That's a weird question. It's hard to say. If you or Yipes is commentating even a whack tourney, I'll watch it just for you guys. Well, thank you, the Muffin Man. Much appreciated. And honestly, I've actually managed to commentate with Yipes a couple of times recently, and I love it. It's so much fun. Is there anything you want to say to Sonic Fox? Sonic Fox, you are so fucking good at fighting games. You are pretty much the best at fighting games right now. You would buy Ultra Chen stuff, huh? Okay, I'll think about it. A fighting game with character creation. Too ambitious, impossible to balance. There was a game called Fighter Maker before. DXerd was a 3D fighter on Saturn. It's connected to Toshinden and has IG as a hidden character. I have no idea. Okay, before anyone asks any question, let me ask a question. How do you... what happened yesterday? What did somebody say? So did somebody make some sort of comment that esports is killing small games? I really wanted to talk about that on Uncensored, but I just didn't have enough of the backstory. I've really cut myself off from a lot of social media. I don't read my Twitter feed that much anymore. I used to guarantee read everything, but now I just basically ignore it for my own sanity and my own health. What happened? Like, why was everybody talking about esports killing smaller games? I'm really confused about that. Nothing happened. Okay, so nothing major. Because just everybody was talking about it all of a sudden. And I don't even know why that even came up. Because I don't even think there's any justification in that. I don't think esports is killing any of the smaller fighting games. I don't think that has anything going up there. It's weird. I mean, like I said, I understand where Vi is coming from because I've been there with him through all that battle. I totally understand what he's going through and why he's so frustrated with a lot of the way that people are responding to a lot of things these days. Because, you know, we fought so hard to try to get it to this point. And we're at this point now, and all of a sudden everyone's telling us that we're doing it wrong. But... Alright, thanks Peter0611 for the 9th month in a row, subscription in a row, and he says that he would suck my nuts, asshole. Am I gonna watch BlizzCon? Probably not, I don't know anything about BlizzCon. What happened was that everyone got mad because the better games are not getting the bigger push. Yeah, but that's always a subjective thing, right? Like, is that true? Tekken 7's getting really big pushes, and Tekken 7's a great game right now. What is considered a better game that is not getting a push besides something like Guilty Gear? And that has more blamed with Arxis than anything. Arxis is not doing anything with that game. Whereas Bandai Namco is doing the Tekken World Tour, right? If Arxis did more for Guilty Gear, I'm sure there would be a much bigger a presence for Guilty Gear. How did you and your hubby David meet each other? On Shoryuken.com forums, fighting about how Honda should be balanced in HDR. Because I hated Honda and he loved Honda, and we basically argued about it. And started to respect each other because both of us were arguing from a logical and non-internet way. Like, we were actually being receptive to each other's ideas and stuff like that. So we just kind of gained a respect for each other by default, thanks to that. Killer Instinct is a tough one. Just the Xbox One exclusivity for the longest of time really hurt that game. Really, really hurt that game. The green menus weren't there for Rev 2. They weren't green at first. They were orange at first. What was both sides of the argument for the Honda HDR changes? Well, I mean, it was kind of similar to what David said today, just recently. On Twitter, he was like, I really want these archetypes back in Street Fighter. And one of them he said was like a Fortress E Honda character. And in my opinion, there has never been a balanced Fortress character, E Honda or Blanca or otherwise. They have always either sucked or been way too good. Or like Honda and ST, sucked to a third of the cast and was way too good to another third of the cast. And then just had weird fights with the middle third. Like, there's never been... They've never actually been able to design a Fortress character so that they are fun in a fighting game. Or balanced. Zoning? Yes. Fortress? No. Zoning, the difference between zoning and Fortress is that zoning controls the space on the screen and has to commit to controlling that space on the screen. Fortress characters, they just sit there and have really strong defense. That, to me, basically means you can only kill them with projectiles. And so I just don't think that a Fortress character can exist in a fighting game and be balanced. So I wanted to change Honda drastically in HDR, and he wanted to leave him a lot about the same. And so that's where kind of the argument was going. So stop resisting 4-5, Injustice 1-2, need some stability to be taken serious. Yeah, but that's what Street Fighter 5 is trying to do, right? Street Fighter V hasn't done anything. Street Fighter V is just Street Fighter V. So do we think Arxis will support DBZ more in terms of esports? It's not up to Arxis. It's probably going to be more up to Namco to do all the work. Never understood why ST wasn't released on Super NES. which was so popular back then. Any idea? I don't know. They just decided, I mean, I think it was too late. It was during the transition period, and they eventually ended up releasing it for the, fuck, what was that stupid thing called? Can't even remember what the hell that stupid thing was called. Oh yeah, and Super Street Fighter 2 sold really badly because it was the third time to buy that stupid thing, the 3DO, that's what it was. It was the third time to buy Street Fighter 2 on there. And people are complaining about season passes right now. Like, we bought fucking three versions of Street Fighter 2 on the Super Nintendo. Are you an egg or an oven? I would probably be more of an egg. Are you watching any anime these days? I've never watched anime. What excites you about Mario Odyssey? Just Nintendo never makes a bad game. A Nintendo fanboy. Name a game that could replace Street Fighter V in major esports events. One that could be more fun to watch. Smash Brothers. Did David say anything about the first encounter with Richard Lewis after his Twitter flame? He said they talked a little bit, and he seemed very different in person, I think. But it's not my question to answer. You should ask David about it. So, how do you go about matching energy level styles with co-commentators? It just depends on the commentator. You really have to know how to balance yourself and find the right rapport with them. So it's interesting because with David, for example, I will make puns to annoy him. But with Yipes, I make puns because he likes the puns. And he always is like, yo, that's bars. Like, I don't know if you guys actually saw, we did the tournament in Iowa that not a lot of people saw. But, like, I had some awesome puns in that one. Like, I was actually saying that I really, really wish that MVCI had snapbacks in the game. And then Yipes was like, I don't know, snapbacks would be kind of broken. But I was like, see, I want snapbacks in the game so you could snap someone out, the guy would jump in, and then you would activate the reality storm, and then you could say, snap back to reality. And he just looked at me, he was like, yo, that's bars. That's bars. So it's different. Like with Jeremy, if I'm with Vicious, it's just about joke making all the time. When I'm with David and Sajam, I do more emotional yelling because they are both very, very, they are very technical commentators. So I try to bring the emotion in there as much as possible. Yes, Maximilian Dude is absolutely right. So on a scale of 1 to 10, how amazing is Maximilian Dude's hair? So on a scale of... I'm trying to think of someone in the FCC with terrible hair to Sajam. Max's hair is pretty fucking legit. I'm going to say that much. It's pretty legit. Remember when the games were like $69.99 for the regular? Dude, Favorite type of pizza? Sausage. Sausage pizza. I love me some sausage. When that sausage gets in my mouth. Let's see. Why is there no fighting game based on the He-Man cartoon from the 80s? That would be sick. Actually, that would be really cool. I really honestly want to make a YR Kung Fu fighting game. I want to make a YR Kung Fu fighting game, a rival schools fighting game, an Avatar fighting game, or a brand new franchise based off of Chinese martial arts fighting games. Because I want to create a fighting game that's about quick attacks and lots of blocking. Because I want a fighting game that's actually you bastard! And then like that, you know, like I want a fighting game based off of that. Like that's the kind of thing I want. I don't know how it would work, but I really want that kind of an old school Shaw Brothers kind of fighting game. I think that's really, really cool. So yeah, I mean, back to that commentator question, honestly, I'm multiple commentators with different people, very, very different commentators with a lot of different people. So at Evo, for example, I did commentary with Z, I'm a different kind of person. With David, I'm a different kind of person. Even when I was doing commentary with Cujo Kate, I was doing a very different thing, you know, just to balance with the other person. And it really takes a lot of work to be a good commentator who can adapt to all the different people. And honestly, I think I'm one of the best at that. I feel like I work with everybody really, really well. I can't name you a commentator that I don't really work well with. to be honest with you. Have I taken speech class? No, I have not. You can tell because my speech is actually pretty fucking awful. I repeat phrases over and over and over again. I have certain keywords that I say all the time, like basically and actually. I say to be honest, not gonna lie, you know, to tell the truth, that kind of stuff a lot when I shouldn't. I add the word here and there to the end of sentences that I shouldn't be doing. My speech is actually really terrible. In fact, it probably would help me a lot to go to some sort of broadcasting school, although I never want to actually talk like a broadcaster. Let's see here. Did I actually play Weapon Lord? I never did. Well, you were a software developer. Use them skills and make that game, son. Dude, it would be fun. Speaking about Kate, when are you two marrying? Is that something people actually want to see? Oh, man. Play Fight Kate. I should. But I don't even want to play Fight Kate. I need to hook up my NES and a super gun so I can really crack out on some Tetris. I need to crack out on some Tetris. You know what? Right. Right. And such like that. Yeah, actually, I've been kind of doing kind of good on that, actually. How many bitches did you smash back in the day in the FGC? Back in the day? Back in the day before anything FGC happened? I was a nerd, okay? I was a nerd. So let's not even talk about that question. Did I play Ikaruga? Of course I fucking played Ikaruga. What a fucking amazing game. That's one of those shooter games that when it came out, because I used to love shooters, shmups. I used to love shoot 'em ups. And I was always trying to think of the perfect way to make a shmup that was skill-based and still difficult. And then they came out with Ikaruga, and I was like, you fucking geniuses. You fucking geniuses. You fucking geniuses. God, Ikaruga was so cool. Ikaruga was so cool. I cannot 1cc. I'm terrible at the game, but my god, that was such a great idea for the game. In case you guys didn't know, the way Ikaruga worked was that every bad guy was either black or white, and they shot bullets that were either black or white or beams that were black or white. Technically dark red and white, but black and white makes it easier, and your ship could flip from white to black. And when you were white, you could pass through all white bullets and gain special weapon power. And when you were black, you could pass through all the black bullets and beams. And so you would just have these giant patterns of black and white beams and bullets everywhere. And you would flip back and forth and absorb and blip, blah, 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 and like develop these patterns. And not only that, but you could develop combos in the game. If you shot three whites and then three blacks and three blacks and then three whites and three... Oh, God, this is totally getting fucking now... I'm so not going to get advertisement for this video now because of that sentence. Jesus Christ. If you destroy... Fuck! Any case, you could combo in the game. Jesus Christ. Fuck. Clipped. If you can't afford DLC, you're just poor and a loser. Suck. Make nuts. A whole. That's basically what's gonna happen now. Oh, man. On that note, I think I'm gonna call it for the day. I've already been streaming for 2.5 hours, so, Alright, I'm going to call it for a day. I'm probably going to take a little bit of break. Sorry about none of the videos being up on YouTube recently. Traveling this weekend, traveling last weekend, it's really made it hard for me to find time to edit and put things up on YouTube. So a lot of this stuff is going to be late. I was supposed to edit today, but I'm feeling really lazy, and I really just want to see if I can beat the Varu Radhanya temple later on today. So I probably won't do any editing today. So you're going to have to wait next week for a lot of this stuff to show up on YouTube. I do apologize about that. But that's probably all it for today. Thank you guys for tuning in. Thanks guys for hanging out. Hope you guys enjoyed this Q&A session. I think people really like it when I just sit here and answer questions all the time. So, but yeah, yeah, no problem, Mr. Keebler. Definitely check it out if you want. So, Thank you, Samurai VR. Much appreciated. I hope people do enjoy the uncensored streams. I hope people have a good time here. I just like to talk with people and just answer questions to everybody. So, thanks for tuning in. Again, if you guys do like the content, subscribe. Use Amazon Prime for subscription. Bits, donations, all that stuff. Follows is really good as well. And also, you know, just let people know that Uncensored was awesome. And that you enjoy it a lot so I can retweet it and maybe get more people to come and watch. So, in any case, thank you guys for hanging out. Thank you guys again. Also, don't forget to join the Discord as well. You can see that I just put the Discord link in there. That is Discord where people just come, suggest Uncensored topics, talk about fighting games, talk about random stuff. A lot of good conversations going on there, fun stuff. Not enough conversations in there, so let's get more people in there and have some fun talks about stuff. So, and even someone asked me, like, hey, can you help me, James? Here's some match footage. And I was like, sure, I'll take a look at this match footage. And I'll probably do a Mind's Eye episode about it because there's some really important stuff about that episode, those matches. But, you know, I gave him some advice, feedback right away, and he said something clicked, and he started doing better. You know, that's kind of stuff that happens in my Discord in any case, so... In any case, thanks guys for tuning in. And again, if you guys want access to cool emotes, damn it, Ellis Draps, you have ruined me. Actually, on the screen over there, it's actually correct. Interesting. Not sure how that happened. There we go. You can get my Nathan Cat emotes and stuff like that. So, and I am fixing the Ultra Chen TV emotes, so I'll get those fixed. But thank you, Ella Straps. Much appreciated. Much appreciated for the kind words. Thank you very much. So I will talk to you guys later. Have a good night. And don't forget, if you can't afford DLC, you're just poor and a loser. Suck. Maynuts. A whole... Suck my nuts, assholes. Peace out.
You shall die by my arrows.
Your arrows are like you, weak and twisted. I fear them, not...
I'll burn you to death with these flames. How do you want it done, rare or medium?
Sorry, I don't like roast pork.
Hey, guy! Let my baby Betty throw you a kiss!
You're some weirdo naming your helicopter.
I guess you're what they call an uninvited guest.
So what are you gonna do with me?
I'll throw you into the sea after I get you.
So we meet finally, Dr. Garcia.
Guy Kazama, you have foiled every one of my ambitions. You're going to have to pay for this.
I guess those three were no match for you. Let me be your opponent now.
Mr. Lee, this tower's beginning to look like your tombstone.